Good evening. It is my pleasure to host this evening's Bangalore Intensive Care Education Program from Rajarajeshwari Medical College, Bangalore. I am grateful to Dr. Pradeep Rangappa and the entire team of ACME and BICEP for having given us this opportunity. We have a list, we have speakers from our college, Dr. Sajananda, Dr. Soumya, Dr. Joyce, Dr. Jyoti, Dr. Rashmi, Dr. Vivek, Dr. Anaga, and myself, Dr. Rangalakshmi. I'm Professor Head from the Department of Anesthesia and Critical Care. Before I begin the program today, a brief curtain raiser about the Airway workshop, which we will be conducting next year as part of the Global Intensive Care Symposium. Now, this is our college, and we hope to have a maximum of 80 participants. And this workshop is going to be a one-day workshop. And along with the evaluation of Airway, we will be having didactic lectures in the morning. And there are going to be 8 stations in the afternoon where we are going to be giving you a good hands-on experience. Now, pricothyroidotomy, we hope to get a cadaver, which is different about this workshop. And of course, we will be having stations on supraglottic airway devices. You will be learning fiber optic intubation, both on mannequin, and if possible on a patient, because then there is going to be a percutaneous tracheostomy also. This is the program. And we will be showing you a jet ventilator, video laryngoscopes, all types of video laryngoscopes, and we are going to be showing you HFNO. These are our stations. There is going to be a station on ultrasound assessment of airways and some of the latest adjuncts to the airways, such as ventilating boogies, lighted stillets, will also be shown to you. So please register in large numbers. As soon as the registration opens, we hope that we will be able to start it or conduct it as soon as the COVID is done. Now, moving on to today's program, our topic for today's program is airway management in critical care with advanced difficult airway management. I welcome you all. And we celebrated World Anesthesia Day on October 16th this year. I don't know how many of you are anesthetists in this group. Now, the theme this year was occupational well-being of anesthesiologists. I think we can extend it to occupational well-being of healthcare workers, especially critical care physicians. I first start this by saluting all the critical care physicians who are joining this program with a big thank you in management, excellent management, I should say, especially in India, of the COVID pandemic. Now, we will begin this session with an evaluation and assessment of difficult airway. I want to make an announcement at the outset that all questions will be taken at the end. There is a Q&A box below. Kindly post your questions and we will have the panelists provide the answers at the end of the session. So this first talk will be about basics. Dr. Jyoti will also be telling you about the various indices, practical tips for airway assessment, and such that a quick assessment can be done and the intensivists can be prepared with airway and adjuncts, even in the emergency room. Over to you, Dr. Jyoti.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everybody, respected seniors and my dear colleagues. I thank you all for being with us virtually, and I personally thank our HOD, Dr. Rangalakshmi ma'am, for giving me the opportunity to present the evaluation and identification of a difficult airway in critical care settings. The need for airway assessment in ICU can never be overemphasized because difficult intubations are common in ICU, emergency department, and pre-hospital settings, and they range from 8 to 13%. The incidence of complications related to tracheal intubation are also pretty high. The fourth national audit project report from the Royal College of Anesthesiologists and Difficult Airway Society found that more than 60% of airway complications in ICU lead to death or brain damage. And they cautioned that failure to assess and identify potential difficulty or poor judgment may contribute to poor outcome. There lies the importance of airway assessment. Airway assessment is done to diagnose the potential for a difficult airway for optimal patient preparation, proper selection of equipment and technique, and participation of the experienced person. ASA defines difficult airway as a clinical situation in which a conventionally trained expert medical person experiences difficulty with mask ventilation, difficulty with tracheal intubation, or both. And difficult tracheal intubation is itself defined when the person takes more than 3 attempts, longer than 10 minutes, or fails despite the best attempt. The method of airway assessment can be summarized like this. It includes the history, a clinical examination, some indices, some specific indices for ICU, and some investigations. Thorough clinical history is always of paramount importance to assess the difficult airway, like a history of disease or surgery of the head and neck, history of trauma or burns, or a medical condition like a diabetes mellitus, rheumatoid arthritis, or an acromegaly, etc. Going through the quick general examination, we have to look for the 4 Ds. We have to see for the dentition, the distortion of the airway due to the edema, blood, vomit, etc. The disproportion, like a short chin to larynx distance, bull neck, large tongue, or a small mouth, dysmobility of the joints, massively obese or a pregnant patient, or a person with a beard. Predictors of difficult mask ventilation can be remembered as obese, where obesity, O stands for obesity, bearded person, an elderly more than 55 years, a snorer, or an edentulous patient. Difficult laryngoscopy and intubation can be assessed by individual indices and group indices. In the individual indices, we have physical examination indices, radiological indices, and advanced indices. And in the group indices, we have some indices which I will be dealing briefly. Starting with the physical examination indices, we have to assess the movement of the joints, like the cervical and atlanto-occipital joints, where the flexion should be more than 25 to 30 degree and extension should be 80 to 85 degree. Here, grade 3 and 4 indicate a difficult laryngoscopy. Then we have a direct test called Delikin's test, which I will be demonstrating later. Then we have some indirect assessment tests like a palm print test and prayer sign, which help us to assess the stiff joints, like a stiff cervical joint. Next, coming to the temporomandibular joint function. The mouth opening should admit 3 fingers, or it should normally more than 5 centimeters. Less than 3 centimeter indicates a difficult laryngoscopy, and less than 2 centimeter indicates a difficult LMA insertion. Then we have to see for the sliding function of the mandible, which I will be demonstrating later. Then we have a Calder's test, where a mandibular protrusion test, where lower incisors should be protruded anterior to the upper incisors. And if at the level or behind it, that indicates a difficult mouth opening. Next is the assessment of the mandibular space, which can be done by thyromental distance, called as a Partille's test. The normal value should be more than 6.5 centimeter, and a value less than 6 centimeter or less than 3 finger width indicate a difficult laryngoscopy. And hyomental distance normally should be more than 6 centimeter and less than 4 centimeter indicate an impossible laryngoscopy and intubation. quick assessment of the oropharynx can be done, where we have to see the narrowness of the palate and the malampati graining, where, as everyone know, grade 3 and 4 indicator difficult intubation, difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Next, coming to the assessment of quality of glottic viewing. Here, ideal test like an indirect mirror laryngoscopy test, direct laryngoscopic grading like Cormac-Lehane grading, and the percentage of glottic opening scoring, these are very difficult to do in an ICU setup. Ease of intubation can be graded depending on the extrinsic manipulation required or adjunct required for intubation. Thyroid floor of the mouth distance should be more than, should admit more than two fingers, should be more than two fingers. The ratio of height to thyromental distance is a useful bedside screening test. A value more than 23.5 is a very sensitive predictor of difficult laryngoscopy. Sternomental distance, a minimal acceptable value is 12.5 centimeter. It has a high sensitivity and specificity. Then we have an upper lip bite test, where the patient should be able to bite the upper lip above the vermilion line. If not, that indicates a difficult mandibular movement. In 2013, a clinical test called thyromental height test was published in Journal of Anesthesia and Analgesia, which measures the vertical height from the anterior border of the thyroid cartilage and anterior border of the mentum. The minimal acceptable value should be more than 50 millimeter, and it has a sensitivity of 83% and specificity of 99%. Then we have some group indices, which we will be dealing briefly. First is the Wilson's scoring system, where the weight, head and neck movement, jaw movement, the receding mandible and buck teeth are taken into consideration, and a score is given from 0 to 2. A score of 5 or less indicates an easy laryngoscopy. A score of 8 to 10 indicates a difficult laryngoscopy. Then we have a Benumoff's 11 parameter analysis, where we can be remembered as a 4-2-2-3 rule, where 4 parameters are for tooth, 2 for inside the mouth, 2 for the mandibular space, and 3 for the neck examination. Minimal acceptable value is given, and that will help us to assess the difficult intubation. Then we have a Sagai and Safavi score, where weight, tongue protrusion, mouth opening, upper incisor length, malampati class, and head extension are taken into consideration. Presence of any three or more indices indicate a prolonged laryngoscopy time. Then we have an Arnais simplified score model, where some risk factors like a previous knowledge of difficult intubation, pathologies associated with difficult intubation, any clinical symptoms of airway pathology, an inter-incisor gap, thyromental distance, head and neck movement, and malampati are taken into consideration, and a scoring is given. A score of more than 11 is predictive of difficult tracheal intubation. An easy way to remember multiple tests is by Dr. Binion's Lemon Law, where we have to look externally, we have to evaluate a 3-3-2 rule, which I'll be dealing in the next slide, then look for the malampati classification, look for obstruction of the airway, and look for the neck mobility issues. So 3-3-2 rule means the patient, the 3-finger mouth opening, 3-finger mentum to hyoid bone, and 2-finger floor of the mouth to thyroid cartilage. So let me demonstrate the 3-3-2 rule for you.
We have a volunteer here. We'll demonstrate a 3-3-2 rule for you. Three finger mouth opening, 3-finger hyomental distance, and 2-finger floor of the mouth to thyroid cartilage. Since we have a volunteer, I'll also demonstrate some of the tests which we have already discussed. First is the Delicant's test, where the clinician should place the one index finger over the patient's chin and another index finger over the patient's occiput. Then we have to tell the patient to look up. If the finger on the chin is above the level of the occiput, that indicates an easy intubation. If it is at the level or below the level, that indicates a difficult intubation, difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Then a sliding function of the mandible can be done, where index finger is kept in front of the patient's tragus and thumb is kept on the mastoid process. Patient is asked to open the mouth. When the patient opens the mouth, we can feel the indenting of the index finger due to sliding function of the mandible. Then we have a Calder's or a mandibular protrusion test, where the lower incisors should be able to protrude anterior to the upper incisors. If not, that is a difficult indicator of difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Then we have an upper lip bite test, where the patient should be able to bite the upper lip above the vermilion line. That indicates that's a normal hand. If not, that is a difficult intubation. Thank you. We will be dealing with this demonstration in detail. During our forthcoming airway workshop, which will be held next year. I request everyone to please register. Coming to some indices which are specific for a critical care setting. I will be discussing two important indices, Makocha score and a Haven criteria. Since 2013, a 7-item simplified scoring system called a Makocha score is being used in a critical care setting. It takes into consideration factors related to the patient, factors related to the pathology, and factors related to the operator, where M stands for a Malampati score of 3 and 4, A stands for apnea, that is obstructive sleep apnea syndrome, C for the cervical spine, reduced mobility of the cervical spine, O for the opening, that is a limited mouth opening of less than 3 cm, C is for coma, GCS less than 8, and H for hypoxemia, a saturation less than 80%, and A stands for non-trained anesthesiologist. Studies have found that the training in anesthesiology, more than 24 months, those who have undergone a training, the success of intubation is more than those who have undergone a training for less than 24 months. So the coding is given from 0 to 12, where 0 indicates an easy intubation and 12 indicates a very difficult intubation. In 2017, a new difficult airway prediction tool called Haven criteria was published in Irish Medical Journal, where a retrospective study was done on 504 patients and airway failure and patients requiring more than one attempt were taken into consideration, and etiologies were organized into 6 categories with an acronym for ease of recall, that is HEAVEN, Haven. So the Haven criteria, H stands for hypoxemia, a saturation value of less than 93% at the time of initial laryngoscopy. Extremes of size, like a pediatric patient less than 8 years of age or a clinical obesity, anticipated to interfere with a bag mask ventilation and visualization of the glottic structure during laryngoscopy. A is for anatomic challenge, that is any structural abnormality that is anticipated with a laryngoscopic view, like trauma to the airway structures, limited oral apertures, a large tongue, short neck, mass lesion or swelling, and a foreign body. V stands for vomit, blood or fluid, where clinically significant fluid is noted in a pharynx or hypopharynx prior to laryngoscopy. E for exsanguination, a suspected anemia which raises concerns about limiting safe apnea times. And N is for neck mobility issues. In 2018, Haven criteria was done on a large cohort, and they found that each of the Haven criteria and total Haven criteria had an independent association with intubation success. In 2019, Nauseen et al. Correlated Haven criteria with a Cormac-Lehane view and intubation success, and he found that patients with a higher the number of Haven criteria had a grade 3 or 4 Cormac-Lehane view. Recently, the position statement of Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine on airway management on COVID-19 patients also recommend the use of Makocha or score and Haven criteria for predicting difficult airway. Coming to some radiographic predictors, a lateral view of X-ray is helpful, but it's difficult to do in an ICU setup. Some parameters are taken into consideration, and we can see for the tracheal compression also in an X-ray.
quick ultrasound of the airway can be of an invaluable tool, where anterior neck soft tissue is measured at three levels, at the level of vocal cord, at the level of thyroid isthmus, and the suprasternal notch. And a value more than 25 mm in zone 1 and an average of all three zones more than 28 mm and neck circumference more than 50 cm are predictors of a difficult airway. If an incidental CT or MRI is done for any other purpose, they can be a helpful adjuvants. Prediction of a difficulty in creating a surgical airway can be remembered as BANG, that is bleeding tendency, agitated patient, neck scarring, and growth or vascular abnormality in region of a surgical airway. So to conclude, airway assessment is an important prerequisite to airway management in critical care setting. Among the various indices available for assessment, each patient has to be individualized depending on the time available for intubation and presence of experts. Simple tests, mnemonics, and scoring systems will go a long way in reducing morbidity and mortality during airway management in critical care setting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jyoti, for an excellent elucidation of a very, very vast topic, which, you know, it is so difficult to cover in 15 minutes due to shortage of time. You have covered it wonderfully. Our take-home message from this talk is, one, this is for trainees who are there in the group. Please remember some of the basic mnemonics. Please remember to do a very, very quick assessment, even in an emergent situation before intubation or airway management in a critical care or an emergency room setting. Remember the MACOCA, remember the LEMON, and remember the HEAVENS criteria. And before always, the rule of the thumb is before starting an intubation or airway management, please make sure you have enough equipment. At least the basic items we require. Now we go on to the next talk, which is by Dr. Soumya Sharma, our assistant professor. And one of the most important safety procedures to extend apnea time is pre-oxygenation, and this is all the more invaluable in a ICU and in an ER. So she is going to be talking about pre-oxygenation and HFNO. We all know that it is this high flow oxygen, which is actually seeing us through this COVID crisis. Over to you, Soumya. As I repeated before, all questions will be taken at the end of the session.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers and my HOD, Dr. Rangalakshmi ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to talk on this forum. In the next 20 minutes or so, I will be covering the principles of pre-oxygenation and in short about high flow nasal oxygen. Tracheal intubation in a critically ill patient remains a risky procedure. Let's be honest, we all have had patients who arrested at the end of successful intubation. There are so many synergistically acting negative factors here. Patient may be unstable cardiovascular, then there may be respiratory instability. Then on top of this, there is high incidence of difficult airway in this population. So in critically ill patient, there is an imminent risk of critical hypoxia during intubation. Because the difficulties with ventilation and intubation are unpredictable, the need for pre-oxygenation is desirable in all patients. Pre-oxygenation is the administration of oxygen to a patient prior to intubation to extend the safe apnea time. Now, what is the safe apnea time? It is the duration of time following cessation of ventilation until critical arterial desaturation occurs. Now, typically, this is considered as 88 to 90%. So it is a time between cessation of ventilation and till the critical desaturation occurs. Now, why 88 to 90% is considered? This is because if you If you see this beautiful sigmoid-shaped oxygen dissociation curve with partial pressure of oxygen on the x-axis and saturation on the y-axis, the point 88 to 90 marks the upper inflection point, beyond which decrease in the partial pressure of oxygen leads to rapid decline in the saturation, about 30% every minute. We can't possibly allow the patient to desaturate below this point. Now, FRC is the reserve of oxygen. It is the volume of air that is left in the lungs after tidal expiration. The aim of pre-oxygenation is to replace the nitrogen in the FRC with oxygen. So pre-oxygenation can also be called as denitrogenation. This has a significant impact on the body oxygen stores and therefore increases the tolerance to apnea substantially. If you look at this graph, as the time of pre-oxygenation increases, there is increase in the storage of blood in the oxygen in the body, which corresponds to increase in the oxygen in the FRC. There is no much difference in the oxygen which is in the tissue and in the blood. We know that the solubility of oxygen in blood is very low. To illustrate the benefit of pre-oxygenation, let's look at the alveolar gas equation. Partial pressure of alveolar oxygen is equal to FiO2 into barometric pressure minus water vapor pressure minus partial pressure of carbon dioxide divided by respiratory quotient. Now imagine a patient who is breathing room air, which has 21% of oxygen. Partial pressure of oxygen will come up to 99.7 millimeter of mercury, which is about 13% of 760 millimeter of mercury. Now, if this patient weighs 70 kgs, his FRC will be somewhere around 2100 ml. So 13% of that will come up to 273 ml. So a person who is breathing room air has 273 ml of oxygen in his FRC. If we consider that his oxygen consumption is 250 ml per minute, he will use this oxygen within 70 seconds. So if we try to intubate a patient who is breathing room air, he'll desaturate within 70 seconds. Now, if the same patient is breathing 100% oxygen, partial pressure of alveolar oxygen will go up to 663 millimeter of mercury. From 13%, it rises to 18%, which is about 1,800 ml of oxygen in his FRC. So he has more than 7 minutes worth of oxygen consumption, which is about 10 times of usable oxygen when compared to breathing room air. We know that pre-oxygenation is beneficial. How do we do that? We can do by providing 100% oxygen for 3 to 4 minutes with a tight fitting bag and mask or with high flow nasal oxygen. One thing we should ensure is that there should be no leak around the mask, which leads to air dilution and decrease in the FiO2. In an OT setting, in case of emergency, we also follow something called 8 deep breath method and 4 deep breath method, where we ask the patient to take full vital capacity breaths within 6 seconds and 30 seconds. Now, extending the pre-oxygenation period from customary 4 minutes to 8 minutes in critically ill patients undergoing emergency intubation study was done. So it was seen that there was no additional benefit when increasing the pre-oxygenation period. In fact, some of the patients desaturated because it jeopardized the oxygenation efforts. So how do we know that we have achieved good pre-oxygenation? There are certain endpoints. End-tidal oxygen concentration of 90%, end-tidal nitrogen concentration of 5% are indicators of good pre-oxygenation. Now, we don't have these indicators in the critical care setting. We can rely upon normal capnogram and ETCO2, which suggests that there is no leak around the mask. We cannot achieve end-tidal oxygen concentration of more than 95% because of the obligatory presence of carbon dioxide and water vapor. Let's consider two sets of patients. We have a normal 70 kg adult who has no pulmonary pathology, he has adequate hemoglobin, his metabolic demands are low, his initial pulse oximeter reading is 100%, there is very low risk of desaturation. He can easily sustain 7 minutes of apnea period. Conversely, in a septic patient who has multilobar pneumonia, who is already hypoxemic with baseline saturation of 90%, despite 100% oxygen, there is immediate risk of critical tissue hypoxia. So So ETO2 of 90% may not be achievable in critically ill patient regardless of the means of pre-oxygenation. So what do we do? Oxygenation can be optimized by certain maneuvers. We can elevate the head end of the patient. CPAP or PEEP can be applied, especially in morbidly obese patients, where oxygenation can be improved by increasing FRC. NIV was found to be more effective than face mask in a particular study in critically ill hypoxic patients. Now, apneic oxygenation is a beneficial in increasing the apnea period. So the physiology behind it is that we continue to insufflate oxygen during intubation. Oxygen continues to be consumed at about a rate of 250 ml per minute. But the carbon dioxide returning to the alveoli is around 20 ml per minute. So there is a negative pressure created within the alveoli, which draws the oxygen along the pressure gradient. So if the airway is unobstructed, we can extend the safe apnea period to more than 15 minutes. Definitely, it will depend on the FRC, body weight, and the patient's metabolic demands. There is another concept which is called transnasal humidified rapid insufflation ventilatory exchange, a physiological method to increase the apnea time. This was first conceptualized by Patel and colleagues. In their study, which included 25 patients who had difficult airway and who were posted for ENT surgeries, they used OptiFlow during pre-oxygenation and also during intubation. What they found out was that the median apnea time was 14 minutes, but none of the patients experienced arterial desaturation less than 90%. So they concluded that Thrive combines the benefits of classic apneic oxygenation and also CPAP and dead space flushing. So further studies followed and to evaluate the usefulness of Thrive. And in fact, it is also included in the IDA 2016 guidelines for tracheal intubation in the intensive care unit. They emphasize the importance of pre-oxygenation, which can be given either by NIV, HFNC, or by nasal oxygen, nasal cannula. They also recommend to continue nasal oxygen with oxygen flow at a rate of 15 liters per minute or with HFNC. So there are certain problems which should be addressed to optimize pre-oxygenation. If the patient is non-cooperative or agitated, consider sedation. If the airway is obstructed, perform airway opening maneuvers, reposition the patient. If there are secretions, suction out the secretions. We can also consider LMA to optimize pre-oxygenation. Insufficient time used for pre-oxygenation is a cause of failure which should be addressed. Inadequate FiO2 because of the leak, or sometimes if the patient is on NIV with, say, 60% FiO2, if we fail to increase to 100% during pre-oxygenation, it leads to pre-oxygenation failure. Inadequate oxygen flow rate leads to rebreathing and air dilution. Pre-oxygenation can also be useful in other situations, like during anticipated interruption of oxygen delivery, such as open tracheobronchial suctioning, before and during awake fiber optic intubation, and before extubation. There are certain concerns like delayed detection of esophageal intubation, absorption atelectasis, but the clinical benefits of pre-oxygenation are far more compared to the potential concerns, which can be readily minimized. This brings me to the second part of the discussion, that is high flow nasal oxygen. There are already overwhelming discussions about HFNC all over the place, so I'll just touch upon the subject briefly. High flow nasal oxygen provides heated, humidified, and titrated oxygen, which can deliver up to 60 liters per minute with FiO2 ranging between 21 to 100%. HFNO is being increasingly used worldwide in the intensive care unit, mainly as oxygen therapy in hypoxemic respiratory failure. These are the components. We need an oxygen source. Then we need a special flow meter, which can deliver flows up to 60 liters per minute. Then an air oxygen blender. Then a disposable humidifier with heating plate. Water has to be provided through a reservoir. Then we need heated circuits, which has low resistance, and then the nasal cannula with wide bore nasal cannula. There is a display screen where it shows flows, FiO2, and temperature setting. Let's understand the beneficial physiological effects. Now, when we breathe normally, we generate a peak inspiratory flow rate up to 15 to 20 ml per liter per minute. When the patient is in distress, this can go up to 120 liter per minute. So if you are using oxygen therapy devices which gives low flow, there will be a lot of air entrainment, air dilution, and low FiO2. But HFNO, because it provides high flow rate, it meets the inspiratory flow demand and it provides stable FiO2. Because of high flow, it exerts resistance to expiration, so it causes CPAP effect, which leads to recruitment of alveoli and increase in the FRC. High flow also leads to expiratory flushing of carbon dioxide from the upper airway, which leads to decreased dead space. Now, this decreased dead space leads to clearance of carbon dioxide, decreased rebreathing, and increased alveolar ventilation. And also it gives humidification comfort to the patient with the beneficial effects like decrease in the inspissated secretions, good mucociliary clearance. HFNO generates a varying level of PEEP. It depends on the flow rate and also whether the mouth is open or closed. In healthy volunteers with closed mouth and flow rates of 60 liter per minute, measured PEEP was as high as 7 centimeters of water. This level of PEEP easily decreases as soon as the mouth is opened. With each 10 liter per minute increase in the flow rate, there is increase in the airway pressure by 0.69 centimeters of water if the mouth is closed, and only by 0.35 centimeter of water if the mouth is open. Coming to clinical applications of HFNC, as we discussed, it improves the pre-oxygenation before intubation. It can also be used for apneic oxygenation during intubation to prevent post-extubation hypoxemia in the ICU and also in the OT, to facilitate bronchoscopy, and in critical care setting, we all know it is being used in acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. This was a landmark study, which is called Florali, which was conducted in France, evaluating the usefulness of HFNC in acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. This was a multi-center study where they included patients with PF ratio of less than 300, and they randomized the patients into three groups, one with high flow nasal oxygen, other in standard oxygen therapy, and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. The primary outcome which they evaluated was the proportion of patients intubated at day 28. Secondary outcome was the 90-day mortality. Now, this was a negative study. They did not find any difference in the intubation rate in any of the groups. But interesting thing here is there was a significant difference in high flow nasal oxygen group in terms of mortality. The study also showed that intubation requirements were significantly lower in patients with PF ratio less than 200. This summarizes the effects in high flow in hypocapnic respiratory failure. High flow exerts flow both during inspiration and expiration. During expiration, it causes PEEP effect. There is alveolar recruitment. Because of high flow, there is dead space washout. During inspiration, it covers the peak inspiratory flow demand. It provides high FiO2. There is alveolar recruitment. All these effects translates into improvement of PaO2 and PaCO2. This, along with the humidification and patient comfort, decreases the work of breathing, decreases the inspiratory effort, respiratory rate, and minute ventilation. Clinical applications of COVID-19. Early published reports in China recommended against the use of HFNC because of the concern of high aerosolization. There were questions which were raised about the safety of healthcare workers, but several papers have come up. This is a particular paper which came in European Respiratory Journal. This study evaluated the oxygen delivery devices with the help of a mannequin and simulator with the smoke particles as aerosols of less than 1 micrometer. And they illuminated the smoke with laser light. What they found was that with the increase in the flow, there was increase in the dispersion distance. But the exhaled smoke dispersion distance with HFNC with 60 liter per minute was very similar to that of simple mask. In fact, it was much lesser than other oxygen therapy devices like non-rebreathing mask and Venturi mask. This is another study which was done with mask and without mask. Obviously, without mask, the dispersion distance was much higher. If we place a simple surgical mask over the patient's face, then the dispersion was much lesser. So what we can do is to set up HFNO, place a surgical mask to decrease the dispersion. Survival Sepsis Campaign released guidelines for COVID-19 pneumonia, and they recommended use of HFNC over conventional oxygen therapy and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, though it was a weak recommendation and with low quality of evidence. What they recommended was the close monitoring for the worsening of respiratory status and early intubation in clinic, if the worsening occurs. So in COVID-19, carefully selected patients in a monitored setting reduces the escalation to intubation and mechanical ventilation. There are benefits of reduced work of breathing. Awake proning is very safe and patient is comfortable. There is recruitment of alveoli because of PEEP effect. It can be used during NIV break and also post extubation. Importantly, in this corona pandemic, it conserves ventilator for patients who have severe hypoxemic respiratory failure. How do we set up a HFNO? We have to make sure that the bronchus does not occlude the nostrils. Flow rate can be slowly increased to achieve better tolerance. Then the temperature can also be increased from 31 to 37. FiO2 has to be set depending on the saturation which we want to achieve. Now, water reservoir has to be placed as high as possible. Continuous monitoring is very important. Clinical response will be seen within 1 hour. If we don't see the clinical response within 60 to 120 minutes, treatment escalation must be considered. During weaning, FiO2 has to be come down by 5 to 10%, and also flow rate has to be come down by 5 liter per minute with frequent reassessment. And we can consider weaning once the flow rate of less than 25 liter per minute with FiO2 of less than 40% is achieved. Now, delaying intubation in inappropriate perseverance with HFNC leads to worse outcomes. If we see a patient whose saturation is dipping, if there is worsening acidosis, paradoxical breathing, if the patient is still tachypneic, if he has altered consciousness, if there is need of vasopressors, and if there is respiratory distress, we should escalate the treatment strategy. There are certain problems with HFNC. It cannot generate higher PEEP compared to NIV. It is less effective in severe COPD. As I discussed, inappropriate perseverance delays intubation, leads to worse outcome. There is risk of aerosol generation. Sustaining oxygen supply is a challenge in resource demanding pandemic setting. Even we have faced this in our hospital. Some time back, we had patients around 500 with most of them on various oxygen therapy devices. We have 12 HFNC machine and we had oxygen shortage. To conclude, when properly performed, pre-oxygenation prolongs the time of desaturation during apnea. Maintenance of patent airway during apneic oxygenation is very important. HFNO delays intubation, improves outcome in acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. However, careful selection of the patients with close monitoring reduces morbidity and mortality. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Soumya. That was an excellent, excellent presentation, done very well in the time allotted. So I have nothing to say about the take home. You have done the take home message so well. It's just that, please, let's not ignore pre-oxygenation. While we are getting the scope ready, let us continue to give oxygen. Now, every ICU has an HFNO machine with this in this COVID era. So let us keep one in every ICU at least, and let us give as much oxygen as we can before we start our procedure, because that is going to go a long way in reducing the morbidity of the patient. The initial oxygenation is very, very important. All of us also have capnogram, and I find that capnogram is largely ignored in the ICU setup. So let's all first connect the patient to the capnogram. And the fourth most important take-home point, which Soumya told very well, is place the mask over a patient of COVID with HFNO so that you are safe. So thanks, Soumya. I repeat, please place your question and answer, put your question and answers in the Q&A box, and we will be taking them up at the end of the session. The next talk is on supraglottic airway devices. Now, while supraglottic airway devices are widely used in the OT setup and most anesthesiologists are going to be using it, it is still, I feel, an underused piece of equipment in the critical care setup. So Dr. Soumya MJ, our professor in charge of critical care, is going to briefly touch upon the various devices available. We will be showing videos and we are going to be giving you a hands-on experience in our workshop. Some newer concepts also she is going to be talking, and she's also going to tell us that in fact, so many times it is supraglottic airway devices which come to our rescue in ICU. Over to you, Soumya.
Thank you. Am I audible, ma'am? Hello?
Yes, you are audible. Yeah. Please go on.
Good evening. I'm here to present on role of supraglottic airway devices in ICU. Thank you, organizers, and Dr. Anglakshmi, ma'am, to give me this opportunity. So what are supraglottic airway devices? So they are a group of airway devices that can be inserted into the pharynx to allow ventilation, oxygenation, and also administration of anesthetic gases without the need for endotracheal intubation. So an endotracheal intubation would place the endotracheal tube into the trachea, which is invasive and it goes below the glottis. Whereas the supraglottic airway device is placed above the glottis here. So I'm going to present in two parts, that is uses of supraglottic airway devices or the indications in ICU, and then the description and types of SGS available. In the operating room, we usually use supraglottic airway device as a primary airway device in anesthetizing and ventilating the patients in many of our cases needing general anesthesia. And it is also kept as a backup in difficult airway situation. Whereas in ICU, we have limitations in using the SGS as a primary airway device. We use endotracheal tube for positive pressure ventilation. But here we have to keep the SGS as a backup, that is as a plan B in rescue airway situations and difficult airway. The fourth national audit project of the Royal College of Anesthetists and the Difficult Airway Society found that major adverse airway events were more common in the ICU and emergency room than in the controlled environment of OT. The events were death, brain damage, failed intubation, cannot intubate, cannot ventilate situation, esophageal intubation, airway trauma, tracheal tube displacement, or accidental extubation. And when these events were found or problems arose, they were more commonly managed in out of hours and to be managed by inexperienced staff. So when the problem arose, they were not managed in a logical or a recognized manner. And also there were issues with equipment frequently, like non-availability, lack of training using the equipment, and failure to choose the right equipment at the time. When rescue equipments were used or the techniques, face mask or laryngeal mask airway ventilation, they had relatively high failure. So this highlights the importance of adequate training regarding airway equipment for the ICU doctors and availability of appropriate devices in the ICU, just as is in the operating room. So there are certain challenges during tracheal intubation in the ICU, which makes the intubation scenario as such difficult. This may be due to a trained help may not be available all the time. Like in the operation theater, we always have an anesthesia technician who is very helpful in managing the airway. So even devices like fiber optic bronchoscope, supraglottic airway devices, and video laryngoscope may not be readily available in the ICU. These are quite expensive ones and may be shared by the OR room also. Emergency intubation might be required at any time in the day or night. ICU population, case population is a case mix which belongs to a high-risk group, either because of risk of aspiration or rapid desaturation due to poor lung reserve and hemodynamic instability. And waking up the patient is not an option in ICU at all. In such a situation, most of the time, inexperienced junior doctors may be performing the intubation alone with a limited airway training and poor airway management skills. The All India Difficult Airway Association 2006 guidelines have included supraglottic airway devices, the second generation, into the algorithm. I'm not going to talk much in detail about this, as my colleague will be talking about this in detail. Here, after an initial pre-oxygenation induction and an attempt of laryngoscopy and tracheal intubation, if the tracheal intubation failed, or after face mask ventilation is unsuccessful, if it fails, then a second generation supraglottic airway device is inserted to maintain oxygenation. A maximum of 2 attempts is allowed. And if it is successful, we have to consider one of the following options, that is percutaneous or surgical tracheostomy, or intubate through the device using the fiber optic bronchoscope only, provided expertise is available. Second generation is preferred because it offers some aspiration protection against aspiration. I'm going to come about those features again later. I'm going to tell a few case scenarios, interesting case scenarios in the critical care unit, where LMA was used in rescue airway situation. Here, the author uses an LMA Supreme in a resuscitation of an airway, difficult airway. A 46-year male gentleman who was diagnosed with oropharyngeal carcinoma 2 months back to this admission had come to the hospital with history of oral bleeding. This is the MRI of that patient with an extensive tumor extending to the soft right side of the top soft palate and also lower down structures. About 1 liter of blood was suctioned out of his oral cavity in the emergency room. ENT surgeon also did a nasal endoscopy to find that there was a slow continuous oozing from this tumor site. So this patient also received 3 doses of radiotherapy. He was now posted for a plan for angioembolization was there. So this patient was shifted in the early morning to a critical care unit at 3 a.m. where his hemoglobin was 7.5 grams. On admission, the patient was very restless and irritable. And on examination, his mouth opening was around 1.5 centimeters with trismus. And the patient's vital was unstable. He was desaturating. Saturation was around 70 to 80%. And also tachycardia. Now the patient suffered a cardiac arrest. He became unresponsive and pulseless. CPR was started immediately. Mask ventilation was difficult and it did not increase the saturation beyond 70. Hence, at this stage, a decision to insert an LMA Supreme, a second generation LMA, was made and it was successfully placed and ventilation was possible. The saturation came up to 99 and with the return of spontaneous circulation. After this, the patient underwent an open crash tracheostomy and the bleeding was stopped after transfusion of FFPs and tranexamic acid without the need for angioembolization. Later, he was stabilized and moved out of the ICU in 2 days. This is another interesting case where LMA was used for a prolonged use in 40 hours in the ICU after a rescue airway. A 52-year-old male patient with a body mass index of 26, that is, he was obese, was admitted for endoscopic polypectomy of the left colon. Intraoperatively, there was continuous bleeding, and to control the bleeding, an open surgery was proposed later. And then with the PAE, it showed all features of difficult airway. After anesthesia induction, ventilation was possible, but intubation failed. A size 4 proceal LMA was inserted easily at the first attempt and the surgery continued. Intraoperatively, the airway pressures were 14 to 16 centimeters of water and also a gastric tube was inserted through this tube. He needed many transfusions intraop with PRBCs and FFPs. He was quite unstable at that stage and was shifted to ICU without removing the PLMA. And a bronchoscopic guided intubation was also tried, where the tube did not go into the trachea. And it was not repeated again because of the coagulopathy. Even a tracheostomy was not an option here because of coagulopathy. After 40 years of continuous mechanical ventilation and after the normalization of coagulopathy, they decided to remove the PLMA once he was stable. And he returned to the ward after a few days. Even I had a similar experience way back when I did my residency. I was a first year PG student. I was posted in ICU and there was one patient, 60-year-old female with a history of obstetric sleep apnea. She came with a marginal hypercapnia and where NIV was started on her in the morning. The same night, she became very drowsy and the nurse calls me. She's totally abandoned. An ABG at that time showed
a PCO2 of 120. So I had to intubate the patient. I tried twice and thrice, and I also called for help. Before that, I had to do something. So I remembered my lecturer saying that LMA is so useful in this situation. I was first year then. So then I inserted a LMA unit, a single-use LMA, and I was successfully, I could ventilate this patient and put her on ventilator with a controlled ventilation for 6 hours, and then later change her to CPAP for another 48 hours. Slowly the carbon dioxide came down and she was stable. I'm sure many of us would have faced the situation and would not have reported as a case report, but it is very useful that way. It is also used as a primary airway device in cardiopulmonary arrest, especially in emergency room or pre-hospital scenarios, where in the hands of BLS providers, it is LMA is much more safer and efficient than the bag and mask ventilation. Even it can be used as an alternate to intubation in ACLS protocol, recommended by AHA and even the European Resuscitation Council. The devices like laryngeal mask airway, combi tube, and laryngeal tube are used for this purpose. Here's another example of using LMA in a different situation. The authors have done a study using LMA for percutaneous dilatational tracheostomy, and they said that it is safer and also reduces the need for paralytics. During this procedure, usually we give a lot of muscle relaxant to stop coughing and also retract the tracheal tube just to lie below the glottis, so that there is space for doing this percutaneous dilatation tracheostomy. Sometimes there is a risk of cuff rupture and also loss of airway here. But they have tried in this stage, just before the procedure, they have taken up the endotracheal tube and placed an LMA here and then continued the procedure as usual. They found that the operative field visibility was good and less interruption through the fiber optic bronchoscope during the surgery. But a Cochrane review on the same study, on the same principle, that is LMA versus endotracheal tube for this procedure, has not recommended any in favor of any of these two, since the low quality of evidence was low. Coming to the second part, that is the types of supraglottic airway devices and the description. LMA is the one which we all know the name, but it is one of the supraglottic airway devices. It is an acronym for laryngeal mask airway, invented by Dr. Archie Brain in 1981, came into use by 1987 to the Western world, and by 1993, a systematic review was also available about its efficacy and safety in using low-risk cases in OT. It is used over 250 million cases, and around 2,500 paper studies are available on classic LMA alone. Coming to the classification, it is mainly classified based on two mechanisms, that is without or with an aspiration protection, that was done by Dr. Cook. And the next one is according to the sealing mechanism, which was proposed by Dr. Millers. And an I in the bracket indicates that it may also be used for conduit for an insertion of tracheal tube. It might be a first generation or second generation, both. So the first generation will not carry any specific mechanism to aspiration protection. Second generation will have gastric channel or the storage container. And according to the sealers, base of tongue sealers and perilyngeal sealers, we have another group with the perilyngeal sealers with a different mechanism than these two classification. Coming to the features, the first generation LMAs or the supraglottic airways are the simple airway devices. They offer low pressure pharyngeal seal of around 16 to 22 and not more than 25 anytime. If the airway pressure of the patient increases beyond this, then there will be a leak which leaks out and hence hypoventilation, or it also enters the stomach to pose a risk of regurgitation and aspiration. So there is no gastric drain as well. So may or may not protect from aspiration and no specific design to lessen the risk. These devices are now only kept as a low risk surgeries. Whereas the second generation one are specially designed for safety. They offer higher pressure pharyngeal seal of 30 to 32 centimeters of water. And also they have a separate gastric drain port like a storage container, which is present. This reduces the risk of aspiration and allows for more efficient ventilation. I'm going to tell you a few of the examples of devices in each classification. LMA Classic is the one original invented by Dr. Archie Brain. It has a cup made of inflatable cuff, which is elliptical in shape. And this is a reusable form. Here is the aperture for ventilation. This is a shaft and a connector to connect. This is available in all sizes, starting from pediatric one size to adult size. And recommended specified volumes of air has to be inserted. The second one is LMA Unique. This is the single-use disposable form. It has a feature similar to the classical LMA. This is called Aura Ones. It's from the Ambu company. If we see here, the shaft is modified to an anatomically shaped. And this makes the placement easier. That is, insertion is easier and also a stable placement. This is also available in pediatric to adult sizes. We have used this in many pediatric cases, hernia cases, and we have done a study as well. This is called the Cobra Perilangeal Airway. Here it has a circumferential cuff, a large volume, low pressure cuff, providing a seal of around 20 centimeters of water. The head is shaped into look like a cobra snake head, hence the name. The tip occludes the esophagus effectively, and these slots are for ventilation as well as it prevents the epiglottis from herniation into the airway lumen. We have the intubating varieties in the first generation LMAs, that is supraglottic airway device. This is called as LMA Fast Track, the first one in its kind. Here the airway lumen, the lumen of this is quite bigger to allow as a conduit for endotracheal intubation of up to 8 size of the endotracheal tube. It has a shaped prefix shape is there, which helps and makes it easier to insert when compared to endotracheal intubation. This allows a blind intubation technique, which needs a little practice, and also fibro optic guided intubation. This has a handle where this can be easily maneuvered against to align against the laryngeal inlet, and also helps for extubation. This is available only 3 sizes, as 3, 4, and 5, with a small adult and regular and large adult. This is also an LMA fast track, but reusable form, and a specific endotracheal tube, which is quite longer, is used along with this. And this is called the stabilizer, used during after intubation during the to hold the place endotracheal tube in place to remove the LMA. This is from Ambu company. Aura I is called as Aura I, another intubating airway device, more soft and flexible. The fourth type, AirQ, where the cuff is specifically designed anatomically so that it improves the placement and good seal. So to some of the first generation devices, they provide relatively low ceiling pressures, no specific mechanism to prevent aspiration. Few of them have a good conduit for intubation. Coming to second generation, LMA ProSeal is the prototype of this generation. And this is a reusable form one, evolved upon the design of classic LMA. It has an additional posterior cuff, which when inflated will have a good airway seal, and also provides a higher oropharyngeal ceiling pressure. It has a gastric tube here and the opening. It has an integral bite block, and it can be introduced using an introducer or a stillet, and recently a stillet or a bougie, which makes the placement much easier. And all other second generation devices are compared with the ProSeal LMA. This is called LMA Supreme. This has a specific curve to facilitate the insertion and make the stable placement. It has a gastric lumen posterior to the airway lumen, making the airway lumen narrower and hence not a very good conduit for intubation. This is a single use form. This is the one which was used in that case report which I told. The third one, called the iGel, and this is a favorite of all of ours. This doesn't have an inflatable cuff. This cup is made up of a gel-like polymer, elastic polymer, which after introduction into the patient will modify itself and adjust and adapts to the anatomical surfaces, and hence provides a good seal. And the chances of sore throat is also less, but as effective as ProSeal LMA, and it also has gastric drain. This figure shows a fiber optic intubation through an iGel, that is a second generation device, with here the tube is in situ. We have the resuscitating devices in second generation, that is laryngeal tube suction. It's called as LTS, disposable. Proximal cuff is a larger proximal cuff, stabilizing the tube, and the distal narrow cuff blocks the esophageal inlet and reduces the possibility of gastric ventilation. Here is the ventilating apertures present. The second one in this is a combi tube. Much before LMAs were found, these were used. It has a double lumen and a proximal cuff and a distal cuff. Most of the time, blind insertion will lead this to the esophagus 95% of the time, and we use the other tube for ventilation. Here are the apertures. But once, if this goes by chance to the trachea, and then we have to switch the tubes for ventilation. We have few other forms of second generation. Here there is no cuffless, it's a cuffless device. It's a preformed plastic cup. It also has a hollow chamber to entrap a gastric fluid of around 50 ml so that it prevents from aspiration. Here it has a, this is called a streamlined liner of pharyngeal airway, that is sleeper. It has a heel, a toe, heel and the bridge. This lateral apertures will fit properly into the piriform fossa. The anatomy shape is made like that. The latest one is the Basca mask. And this sealing mechanism is very different. This is self-inflating dynamic membranous cuff, which is continuous with the airway lumen. So whenever there is a positive pressure, ventilation is applied or the patient inspires, this is self-inflates since it's in continuation, and then it deflates during expiration, thereby providing an effective seal and also thereby avoiding over-inflation. Here is a tag which helps in changing its shape and facilitates its insertion. It also has a gastric tray. A second one, similar to the Basca mask, is 3G laryngeal mask, where the sealing mechanism is same, but it has two tubes for gastric drain, that a gastric lumen for redundancy. To conclude, the second generation generation devices provide a higher sealing pressure and offers greater protection against aspiration, and also allows effective ventilation. Now, the mnemonic rods can be used to predict its placement, difficulty in placement or ventilating. The R for restriction or the airway resistance, obstruction, obesity, distorted anatomy, short thoracental distance, and the stiff lung. Contraindications include no mouth opening, complete upper airway obstruction, including below the larynx, potential pharyngeal and laryngeal pathology, high airway resistance, and poor lung compliance. These factors usually limit the use of SGAs as a primary airway device for ICU patients, since our ICU patients might be having these. A few complications are noted, like injury to pharyngeal mucosa, tongue, uvula, epiglottis, teeth, lips, recurrent laryngeal nerve and lingual nerve injuries, which may occur due to either forceful insertion, repeated attempts, inadequate lubrication, prolonged insertion, too high cuff pressures or compression. But these are all avoidable if we take care. So to conclude, supraglottic airway devices are easier and rapidly inserted for maintaining the airway, providing an oxygenation and ventilation in emergent situations, also provide a conduit for intubation in difficult airway situations, and is safer when a right device is used in trained hands. Please visit this site called openairway.com, where many videos are present for insertion techniques, and I have not included one because of its lengthy and the shortage of time. Also, we will have station, as Madam said, we will have station in the workshop for practicing this on mannequins. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Soumya. That was, you have covered so many devices. I dare say some of our critical care fellows, there is no need to be confused. There is a logical insertion sequelae to each and every device which he has said. Suffice to say that one, they are life-saving. Two, they are especially useful in less skilled trainees. But again, just because they require less skill compared to intubation does not mean they are easy. You need to know the technique, and in the, again, untrained hand, they can cause damage. So please do it the right way and attend our workshop. We move on to the next. As again, I repeated, there are some questions on HFNO on pre-oxygenation. We will take them at the end of the session. Some of the questions are very relevant, and Dr. Soumya Joyce will be answering them. Please post your questions if you have any on the other talks. While pediatric patients are not very common or not common at all in the adult intensive care setup, I have included this talk because in this era of COVID, the doctors need to multitask, and you know the number of doctors inside the COVID wards have to be limited for everybody's safety. So a little knowledge about pediatrics is essential. So Rashmi, our assistant professor, is going to be covering basics of pediatric airway and reviewing some difficult airway algorithms in pediatrics. Over to you, Dr. Rashmi.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm Dr. Rashmi, and I would like to thank the organizers and my HOD, Dr. Rangalakshmi, for this opportunity. My topic for today is basics of pediatric airway management. I'll be covering this topic under following headings: principles of pediatric airway assessment. I'll also be reviewing difficult airway algorithm with its unique considerations for pediatric patients. I'll also be talking about advantages and disadvantages of various pediatric airway equipments. This figure, it shows what's the difference between the pediatric airway and the adult airway. As we can see, the occiput of a child is relatively large to the rest of the body, and the flexion of cervical spine can cause obstruction. The larynx is more cephalad and more anterior. The tongue itself, it takes up more room in the oral cavity, causing an obstruction, and it's harder to sweep the tongue laterally during direct laryngoscopy. And epiglottis is large, floppy, omega shaped. It obstructs the view of vocal cords. These are the basic differences which we need to know between the adult and pediatric airway. Now I want to speak about pediregistry. What is pediregistry? It's a multi-center study consisting of 1,018 children with difficult airway from 13 pediatric centers all over the world, which was done in prospective cohort manner. This study demonstrated more than 2 direct laryngoscopy attempts in a child with difficult tracheal intubation is associated with very high failure rates and increased incidence of severe complications. This is first study to confirm that airway management in a pediatric difficult airway population is associated with significant complication rates. In these children, tracheal intubation failed in 19 patients, and 204 children had at least one complication. The most severe complication was cardiac arrest, which occurred in 2% of these children. And the most common complication overall was transient hypoxemia, that is oxygen saturation, less than 85%. This study also helped us to give a definition of what is pediatric difficult airway. It is failure to visualize vocal cords on direct laryngoscopy by an experienced provider. Impossible direct laryngoscopy because of an abnormal anatomy. Failed direct laryngoscopy within last 6 months. And direct laryngoscopy felt to be harmful in a patient with a suspected difficult laryngoscopy. Coming to risk factors and assessment, airway assessment can be done in 2 parts. Will the face mask ventilation be difficult in this pediatric patient? Will the intubation be difficult? Coming to difficult face mask ventilation, any tumor or abnormal phase of the patient due to trauma can prevent proper mask seal, which causes difficult face mask ventilation. Any syndromes associated with mid-face hypoplasia can also cause this. Children with severe obstructive sleep apnea, like children who are having tonsillar problems or adenoids, can have difficult face mask ventilation. What will cause difficult intubation? Mandibular hypoplasia, like in syndromes Pierre-Robin and Treacher-Collins, poor mouth opening, obstructive sleep apnea, stridor, syndromes associated with facial asymmetry, like golden hair syndrome. The common physical finding in a child with difficult airway is short thyromental distance or micrognathia. This micrognathia itself is an independent risk factor for increased adverse events during airway management. Any syndromic and dysmorphic features in a child can be identified in lateral profile. This figure shows what is micrognathia. It is a condition where there is smaller lower jaw. The pediatric study also found 4 independent risk factors which are associated with high risk of complications. It is weight less than 10 kgs, micrognathia or mandibular hypoplasia, greater than 2 tracheal intubation attempts, and 3 direct laryngoscopy attempts before an indirect technique. The fundamental principle of airway management is oxygenation, and it's not intubation because oxygenation is life-saving. What are the strategies which we need to limit the complication? We need to limit the number of direct laryngoscopy attempts. We need to proceed to more advanced devices sooner than later, like video laryngoscope and fiber optic. Always have a supraglottic airway device available because it's useful as a rescue device in every difficult airway algorithm when mask ventilation and tracheal intubation fails. And from the beginning of airway management, consider various methods of providing passive oxygenation to the patient, like nasal cannula and Thrive. What are the considerations we need to keep in mind in unanticipated difficult airway in critical care setting? There will be no adequate time for you to prepare a proper airway plan. No guaranteed help available like senior anesthesiologist or consultant or ENT specialist for surgical airway. No proper advanced airway equipments might be available at that particular moment, like video laryngoscopes, fiber optic. How to evaluate whether the patient will have a difficult mask ventilation? Make the patient lie supine at rest and look for signs of upper airway obstruction like paradoxical chest wall movement or stridor. Does positioning the patient in lateral or prone or use of any nasopharyngeal airway improve this airway obstruction? This may help predict difficult mask ventilation. If we encounter a difficult mask ventilation scenario, what to do? First, give 100% oxygen. Call for help. Try to optimize the head position. Adjust chin lift and jaw thrust. Insert a shoulder roll if the baby is less than 2 years old. Keep a neutral head position if the baby is more than 2 years. If you're giving cricoid pressure, adjust the cricoid pressure. Use ventilating. Using 2-person bag mask technique. That is, one person is holding the mask with 2 hands and the other person is bagging. If equipment failure is suspected, change to self-inflating bag. Consider deepening anesthesia, use of CPAP. If all these are not helping, go to step B, that is insertion of oropharyngeal airway. If the help has not come yet, call for help again. Assess the cause of difficult mask ventilation, like lighter planes of anesthesia, laryngospasm, and gastric distension. If there is gastric distension, pass an NG tube. Maintain anesthesia CPAP. If relaxant has already been given, intubate the patient. And if intubation is not successful, go to unanticipated difficult airway algorithm. If all these are not helping, next step is insertion of supraglottic airway device. Not more than 3 attempts should be taken. And if the cricoid pressure is still there, release it. With the help of supraglottic airway device, if the airway is achieved, then continue with it. But if the ventilation is not proper, check the saturation. If the saturation is more than 80% or whether the saturation is less than 80%. If the saturation is more than 80%, consider any malposition of supraglottic airway device or any blockage. It can be bronchospasm or pneumothorax also. If the saturation is more than 80%, try to wake up patient. But if the saturation is falling, attempt intubation. If you succeed, then proceed from there. But if you fail to intubate, go to cannot intubate, cannot ventilate scenario. For unanticipated difficult tracheal intubation in pediatrics. If the first attempt to intubate is not successful, what to do next? continue nasal oxygen. One more attempt at intubation can should be done. In between the attempts, mask ventilation has to be done. We need to consider changing the device, technique or operator in between the attempts. Continuously maintain the depth of anesthesia. With all these techniques, if we fail to intubate, step two is insertion of supraglottic airway device to maintain oxygenation. Throughout the procedure, we need to continue the nasal oxygen, preferably use second generation supraglottic airway device, maximum of two attempts only, mask ventilation in between the attempts, and consider changing size and type of supraglottic airway device for the second attempt. Maintain the depth of anesthesia. If there is failure of supraglottic airway device, step three is rescue face mask ventilation. Continue nasal oxygen, ensure neuromuscular blockade. Final attempt at face mask ventilation using optimal technique with oral or nasal airway. Consider insertion of gastric tube. With all this, if you are not able to ventilate the patient, this scenario is cannot intubate and cannot ventilate. Next, we have to go to step four, that is emergency surgical airway access. We need to continue the nasal oxygen and efforts at rescue face mask ventilation. Next steps depends on the age of the child. If the child is less than 8 years of age and surgical help is available, go ahead with tracheostomy. But surgical help is unavailable and the child is less than 5 years, the method of choice is transtracheal needle puncture. If the child is 5 to 7 years, it's needle cricothyroidectomy. If the child is more than 8 years, we can go ahead with needle cricothyroidectomy. Coming to equipments and devices, the first equipment which we use is direct laryngoscope. Miller and McIntosh blade, both can be used for first attempt of direct laryngoscopy. Miller is a straight blade. This figure, right hand side, we have Miller blade, left hand side, we have McIntosh blade, which is a curved blade. Usually we use Miller blade in children less than 1 year of age, and this is used to include epiglottis. McIntosh blade is used in children more than 1 year of age, and we usually exclude the epiglottis. Studies comparing McIntosh and Miller have found similar rates of optimal view. The PETI registry found that greater than two attempts at direct laryngoscopy in pediatric patient with difficult airway were associated with greater rates of failure and severe complications. The paraglossal or retromolar technique can be considered for micrognathic child in which tongue cannot be compressed further into submandibular space. This technique involves avoiding tongue altogether by using a straight blade along the buccal mucosa and lifting the epiglottis from the side of the mouth. This technique should be practiced in elective setting in a healthy patient before being utilized in a difficult airway of a small child. In this figure, we can see the Miller blade being advanced through the lateral side. We are bypassing the tongue and lifting the epiglottis laterally to get a glottic view. The pros of direct laryngoscopy, it's widely available. Cons, requires alignment of axis to obtain a laryngeal view. It requires a degree of mouth opening. Multiple attempts are associated with increased complication. Greater workflows needed to displace the tissue versus the other techniques. Coming to video laryngoscope, significantly improves the glottic view and are effective in pediatric patients with known difficult airway. They have more angled blade that can obtain indirect glottic view without having to align the oral, pharyngeal and tracheal axis. In the diagram below, we have compared the McIntosh as well as the blades of the GlideScope. The GlideScope blade is more angled compared to McIntosh blade. The pros are easy to acquire skill, it's portable, less force is required, we get a panoramic or wide magnified view, and it has proven efficacy in difficult airway. The cons are it requires moderate degree of mouth opening, the view can easily be obstructed by blood secretions, time to intubate typically longer than direct laryngoscopy. Coming to supraglottic airway device, it forms a significant part of airway algorithm. It's used when there is difficulty in ventilation, when there has been failed intubation, or both. Newer supraglottic airway devices like AirQ and Ambuora have design features meant to address the limitation, and it is more efficient conduit for fiber optic guided tracheal intubation. The pros are, it's a rescue device, conduit for tracheal intubation, and strong evidence based in difficult airway. Cons are, it requires some degree of mouth opening, risk of pulmonary aspiration when used in patients with full stomach. Coming to flexible fiber optic bronchoscope, it is considered the gold standard of difficult airway management in pediatric patient. We can maneuver the tip around and bypass the distortion in airway anatomy. Scopes comes in numerous sizes, down to 2.2 mm outer diameter to accommodate even very small ET tubes. Pros are, it can be used in limited mouth opening patient. Nasal or oral route can be used and can be used in conjunction with supraglottic airway device. Cons are, it has a very steep learning curve to be proficient with its use. It's expensive and suboptimal view in airway with blood and secretions. Optical stilet. Shikhani's optical stilet is a malleable fiber optic stilet with a distal eyepiece that can either be connected to a video or used on its own. It combines the feature of fiber optic bronchoscope and a light wand. It has a shorter learning curve than fiber optic bronchoscope. It cannot be used for nasal intubation and suboptimal view in airway with blood and secretions. This is the diagram. We have the eyepiece, light source, oxygen port, stilet, and atraumatic tip. The take-home message which I want to give is, difficult pediatric airway management is associated with high rates of complication. Studies which have been done have enlightened us to strategies that will increase our success in managing these airways. The devices designed for children continue to grow. However, use of these devices requires the provider to maintain a high level of proficiency. Thank you.
Thank you, Rashmi. We are running a little behind schedule. I request all speakers to stick to their time. There are some questions also to be answered at the end. Just the take-home messages in pediatrics: do not panic, oxygenate the child, be gentle. Positioning is very important in children, and worthwhile keeping a supraglottic airway device in all ICUs in case you encounter a child. We move on to our next speaker. The topic of our next speaker is going to be one of the burning, or I dare say, most controversial topics of today. That is airway management in ICU. This is going to be addressed by our CineMost faculty, eminent anesthesiologist, director of research in our hospital, Dr. Sajananda. He is going to elaborate the principles of airway management of patients with COVID-19 to encourage safe, accurate, and swift performance drawn on published literature and immediately available information from clinicians and experts. Sir has had a wide experience both in India and abroad, has served in several senior faculty positions, again in both India and abroad. So prevention and contamination of healthcare workers will also be briefly touched by him. Over to you, Dr. Sajananda. Sir, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Rangalakshmi. Greetings from Rajarajeshwari Medical College of Bangalore. My topic today is management in COVID ICU. As you all are aware of, coronavirus 2 is a highly contagious disease, and airway management of patients with this is a high risk to both staff and the patients. So we should aim to encourage safe, accurate, and swift performance. What are the contributing factors for acquiring this infection? Healthcare workers are very close to the patient's airway. At times, the patients become very uncooperative due to hypoxia or altered sensorium. They can vomit, they can cough, making the environment fully flooded. Now, these are the list of procedures that are considered to be aerosol generating events, that is mask ventilation, intubation, extubation, awake intubation, use of high flow nasal cannula, non-invasive ventilation, bronchoscopy, sputum suctioning, procedure of CPR. So the whatever we do in the ICU, that is as regards to airway management, it should be safe. That is simple, safe for the patient and the staff. It should be accurate, avoiding unreliable, unfamiliar, or repeated techniques. It should be swift, timely, without rush or delay. All right, where should we do these airway-related procedures? It's mostly done in a negative pressure room as per the consensus guidelines of various critical care societies. But however, you should have a minimum of 12 air exchanges per hour. And in case if we don't have, then we can also do away with a room with a natural ventilation, having a 160 liters per second for patient of air exchange, or should even have a standalone air conditioner with an exhaust system. All the AGP procedures should be performed using a full PPE equipments, and the masks that are actually recommended are in European setup, they use PPF 3 and N99 masks, whereas in American setup, they use PAPRs and N95 masks. As far as we are concerned, we are using right now N95 masks. We recommend using double or triple pair of gloves for all the AGP procedures. Each ICU should have an airway team headed by either intensivist or an anesthesiologist who is trained and in airway management. The team members should not exceed 5, that means it should be anywhere from 3 to 5. And airway consult rounds should be done every day on a daily basis, both in the emergency department, inpatients, as well as the ICU setup, so that you are aware of which patients might require an intubation, that especially the patient already infected with either COVID or suspected infection, and who are having dyspnea, wheezing, and significant comorbidities. These are the candidates who might come for intubation. So also the signs of respiratory insufficiency, that is tachypnea, hypoxemia, increased workup breathing, stridor, radiographic evidence of worsening disease, or CPR. This is how the airway team for endotracheal intubation and the room, the layout looks like. In the center is the patient on the couch. At the head end is the airway manager or intensivist or anesthesiologist. There is a nurse to help give drugs and monitor to the patient. There is an airway assistant to help the airway, the laryngoscopist. Outside the room, there should be a CPR crash cart, bronchoscope, airway team helper. The bottom figure shows the 5-member team. We use all disposable airway equipment as far as possible in the ICU setup. If economic constraint, we use a reusable equipment. There should be a good protocol for safe transportation and disinfection of these equipments. Every ICU should have an airway cart consisting of all these equipments, the various types of airways, bougies, suction tips, endotracheal tubes, second generation supraglottic airway, tube fixation materials, duplication materials, and the C circuit or ambu bag with a filter and a connection to the entitled CO2 and a video laryngoscope, clamps, etc. Already, Soumya Sharma has already talked about the pre-oxygenation in detail. Anyway, it is suffice it to say that all patients require pre-oxygenation for 3 to 5 minutes. If you are using it, it should be used with a tight-fitting mask with a viral filter between the mask and the respirator is very ideal. As far as possible, try to avoid high flow nasal oxygen or high flow oxygen with reservoir bag for pre-oxygenation. But then if the patients are critical, then you can still use them. And if there is a tight fitting mask already present over the face, you should remove it very gradually from the face onwards towards the foot and reduce the flows and see that the aerosol generation is reduced. Decision to intubate. Well, intubation serves necessary oxygen support prior to accumulation of oxygen debt, which hypoxemia produces. It decreases the patient's self-inflicted lung injury, PSLI, to severe or worsening of the ARDS. It also lessens the need for high-risk emergency intubations. Decreased aerosolization also happens when you intubate, but may decrease the risk of progression to severe acute ARDS. Now, if you are contemplating to use the patient before the intubation, and also the patient may require a reposition, so there should be a helping hand, and you should use a vice grip like this. This is the equipment used for ventilating, that is the ambu bag with a filter, closed suction unit, and a ventilation mask. This is a circuit setup after the intubation, how it is to be connected. There should be a viral filter, E2CO2. Now, oxygenation during apnea and manual ventilation also has been touched by Soumya Sharma. In patient with severe hypoxia, if it is manual ventilation is required, again, the two-handed B&E approach is recommended, or try to use a second generation supraglottic airway with a filter for ventilation during apnea whenever available. You should use a small tidal volume and don't use high flow nasal oxygen for apneic oxygenation. Now, for intubation, we always use what is known as rapid sequence intubation. But if the patients are agitated, uncooperative, a delayed sequence intubation is also recommended. We use hypnotics and paralyzing agents for given successfully through the IV route. And then once the patient is paralyzed, then we go for intubation. Whenever we use neuromuscular blocking ducts, we try to use a higher dose so that the rapid paralysis sits in. That is, if you're using rock uranium, it could be 1.5 milligram per kilo or sex 1.5 milligram per kilo. Well, conventional versus video laryngoscopy. Well, video laryngoscopy worldwide data suggests that 80% of the intubation of these patients have been performed using video laryngoscope. It is better than conventional laryngoscope because it maximizes the operative distance from the airway. We don't recommend any specific video laryngoscope, but avoid video laryngoscope with integrated oxygen channels, and the operator should be experienced in its use or trained in its use. And in our setup, we use bougie with preloaded endotracheal tube for intubations. Now, this is a small, video which has appeared in the Lancet, re-emphasizing the use of video laryngoscope. So this is the conventional direct laryngoscopy, wherein you see that the face of the laryngoscopist is almost very close to the patient's face. This is a video laryngoscopy wherein the patient face is away from the laryngoscopist's face, and indirectly they will visualize the larynx and then intubate. And always use, it is said that single-use blade is better. Now, protocol for intubation and NIV and HFNC, each unit or ICU may have protocols. In general, the patient clinical condition is deteriorating, becoming hypoxemic, work of breathing is increased, and gas analysis show PiO2 to FiO2 ratio less than 150, we go for intubation. If it is more than 150, we go for NIV or HFNC. Then depending on the ROX index, either we go for HFNC or NIV. Now, after the intubation, the correct positioning, a placement of endotracheal tube in the trachea should be confirmed using a capnograph. Some may argue that why not ultrasound? Because ultrasound has come into the play for quite it's become very popular. All right, you can use ultrasound, but then the person who is using it should be very experienced to use it fast. But capnographic confirmation is a must for all the patients. As soon as the intubation is done, then the endotracheal tube has to be clamped. The clamp should be removed only after the inflation of endotracheal tube cuff and the endotracheal tube is connected to the ventilator. If it's an unanticipated difficult intubation, it's second generation supraglottic airway has to be used, which has already been dealt with in detail. then open cricothyrotomy is better using a scalpel and Bougie than percutaneous tracheostomy. But we recommend the use of sedation neuromuscular paralysis within the tracheostomy. Now, once you have intubated the patient, treated the patient, patient has recovered, then we have to extubate the patient. All right, extubation is done and again in a negative pressure room. There is a facility for a good air conditioning. Now, this particular extubation is done in many centers using a barrier device, which are known as aerosol box or hoods. Now, before we land up in extubation, the weaning process must have already been decided by the intensivist and using SBTs, and they were ready for extubation. While extubating, to know whether to assess the ready for extubation, we don't induce the cough to the patient. Otherwise, it's again a catastrophe and it will spread the aerosols. Leak test is not to be done ideally in all the patients, only in those patients who are on a prolonged ventilation, you suspect edema, the larynx, so we use a leak test. No routine nebulization after the extubation. In case, if there is indicated for the therapeutic purpose, use a pressurized metered dose inhaler or direct powder inhalers. And use a surgical face mask for the patient face immediately after the extubation. We're talking about the aerosol blocks. There are different types of aerosol boxes. There's a frame with a plastic sheet on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, you see the University of Minnesota, Mayo Clinic, and the engineering department have come up with a negative pressure hood with a HEPA filter and iris ports. And they have done a detailed study and they published it. It is under publication in the American Journal of Infectious Diseases. And they found that it is very, very useful during the extubation. All right, intubation and airway management guidelines. Now, pre-intubation plan for airway management in negative pressure room, confirm functioning IV line, have an airway equipment and the drugs ready, airway cart should be ready, and then designate the roles for each person who are present inside the ICU. Optimize the hemodynamics before the induction, either by IV fluids or by giving vasopressors, depending on the choice of the intensivist. Then provide high quality pre-oxygenation, which has already been dealt. Then if you want to use, there is a bag mask ventilation with a viral filter. Use a longer acting paralytic, is preferable using racuranium 1.2 or 1.5 milligram, or in case if you are very sure of intubation, faster intubation, you can also use succinylcholine. Consider using either lidocaine and for suppressing the cough, better to avoid fentanyl. Consider video laryngoscopy for initial attempt. And if you're unsuccessful on two attempts, better to go for surgical airway or call for help. Minimize time to cuff inflation and connection to the ventilator circuit. After the intubation is over, dispose of the contaminated equipment, then replace the outer gloves, then start the ventilator using the different ventilator settings. Maintain adequate sedation and paralysis to minimize the dyssynchrony of the ventilator and the patient. During the extubation, again, the number of persons should be minimum inside the room, designate the roles, check for cough leave, prepare for possible reintubation scenario and post-extubation oxygen support. Consider using, again, lidocaine or some other drug injection to limit the coughing. Discontinue the circuit flows prior to extubation. Immediately dispose of the endotracheal tube and any other contaminated airway supplies in a sealed container and send it for sterilization. This algorithm is meant for emergency intubation. It is almost similar except that you prepare for a difficulty. You have different plans. Plan A is RSI, that is rapid sequence induction. Plan B, 202-person mask ventilation. Plan C is second generation supraglottic airway. Plan D is front of neck airway scalpel using a scalpel and Bougie. Now, fiber optic, this will be dealt by the next speaker. Should we do nebulization routinely? Usually, it is not advocated in COVID patients. If it is definitely indicated, we use PMDA or DPI, as already I've spoken to you about. And if you want to use a nebulizer, it should be in a ventilated patient, it should be a mesh nebulizer instead of jet nebulizer. This is how a mesh nebulizer is connected in the inspirator limb. There is a HME filter. This is at the Y piece, same mesh. This is the mesh nebulizer, which is connected and HME filter. We do not advocate open suction in the ICUs. We use a closed inline suction device for airway toileting. Well, at times the tracheostomy may be required in ICU setups. So we should adapt some strategies to reduce aerosol generation in the surgical field. A good collaboration between anesthesiologist and surgeon is very important, or intensivist and surgeon is very important. Pre-oxygenate the patients, advance the tracheal tube beyond the surgical site, and you must pause the ventilation during the open tracheal and tube exchange phases. All right, and some adverse events like cardiopulmonary arrest might take place in the ICU. So if you want to do a CPR, the healthcare worker should be donned with PPE and use compression only CPR than the chest compression. Rather than the conventional CPR. Early use of advanced airway device during CPR is advocated. While placing this advanced airway, you should interrupt the chest compression. And use of ICU ventilator for ventilation during CPR instead of manual ventilation is always highly recommended whenever it's possible. Well, we must support skills development in the current climate. We must always train our juniors of the airway response team in acquiring video laryngoscopic skills and direct laryngoscopy skills. This should be done simulation accompanied by multimedia visual aids, and it should enhance the clinical experience and airway skill acquisition. This should be done repeatedly at least once in a week so that everybody is conversant with the various support skills. This is how we do in our setup. The training session, this is one of our residents who is learning how to do this intubation. Holding now, he's shown the holding of the mask, vice grip method, and then these are the drugs and equipments are already assembled. And then now he will go for video laryngoscopy. He's learning how to do a video laryngoscopy. Inserting the blade, visualizing the larynx. And then he will guide the endotracheal tube into the glottic opening, through the glottic opening into the trachea. It is advancing the tube, and then he will remove the tube. Excuse me, sorry. Connecting it to a ventilator circuit with a HME filter, viral filter. He's clamping the endotracheal tube. Like this, we should train our juniors. So to conclude, close monitoring of respiratory status for early signs. These procedures.
We are not able to hear you properly, sir.
Airway management in COVID-19 patients could be challenging due to many unknown risks. And it is always best to follow simple, reliable, and familiar techniques that are safe for both the patient and the healthcare workers. These are my references. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Sir, if we could applaud, we would give you a huge round of applause for that. And this was a very concise and precise way of depiction. It was a very big topic. And each and every slide of yours was important. And suffice to say, training is important. Sedate always, use NMJ. Sir said there is no need for routine leak test. Plan for intubation. Nebulization can be done. Please do not be scared. Several of our brethren have benefited by tracheostomy. I think maybe we are delaying tracheostomy a little bit in the current situation. And thank you very much, sir. Any questions posed to Dr. Sajananda will be taken at the end. We move on to the next talk, which is failed intubation. Now, we will be extending our time, I think, just by about 10 to 15 minutes because of the initial hiccups. Now, failed intubation is a situation we all dread, but each one of us, I'm sure, have faced it sometime or the other, and we have lost patients to this. Dr. M.V. Anagam will tell us steps and algorithms to manage failed intubation, including some of the newer adjuncts. Dr. Anagam, please let's be, of course, you need to tell everything, but please let us stick to time. Over to Dr. Anagam.
Thank you, organizers and Ranglakshmi Madam, for this opportunity. So I'm going to discuss today regarding the management of failed intubation. Now, what is the role of an airway manager? His primary objective is to provide pathway for oxygenation. So how do we achieve this? This can be achieved with the help of a face mask or a supraglottic airway or a tracheal tube. If one method fails, an alternative method can be used to avert hypoxia. Now, each unsuccessful attempt to maintain this oxygenation will be a time lost and incrementally will increase the risk of hypoxia, trauma, and airway obstruction, which may need a surgical airway. Now, then why is ICU airway management different? Now, airway management in the critically ill patient may occur in the ICU itself or almost anywhere else in the hospital environment. Many of these locations are always remote. None are designed with the airway management primarily in mind, and they are all present logistical challenges. While some of these airway interventions will be planned, most of them, as we all know, are reactive and emergent, often with the intubating team called urgently to a rapidly deteriorating patient with a chaotic situation around us. Now, patient factors often contribute to difficulty. In the emergency setting and with a patient who may be hypoxic, who is obtunded, who is combative, or all the three of which are included, airway assessment will be difficult and often cannot be performed to the highest of the standards. Now, in this scenario, a rapid sequence induction will be considered appropriate in most of these patients because of the lack of NPO status, an intra-abdominal pathology might be present, or a functional gastric stasis. Now, the vast majority will have an unstable physiology even before anesthesia is induced. This includes like a pre-existing hypoxia. There could be a ventilation perfusion mismatch, which will impair the pre-oxygenation. There could be absolute or relative hypovolemia and an increased risk of myocardial impairment. Now, importantly, but which is little discussed, is the lack of skilled assistance and the adequate equipment when managing the airways of critically ill patients in a high tension situation, which can impact the delivery of a prompt, a safe, a skilled airway management, especially when difficulty occurs and non-standard plans are required. Now, what are then the impacts of these multifactorial issues on the outcomes of airway management in ICU? Firstly, the failure to intubate is much more likely when inducing anesthesia in the ICU. Failure at first intubation attempt can be expected in 10 to 12% of the patients, significantly higher than during anesthesia practice in the operation theater. The complications and cardiac arrest increases significantly as the number of intubation attempts increases. Now, how do we manage a case of failed intubation in the ICU scenario? We'll go from stepwise from unanticipated difficult airway to a patient having failed intubation. So I'm going to discuss the IDA 2016 guidelines for the management of a failed intubation. Step one, what we're going to do for a patient who needs intubation in an ICU are, as discussed earlier, pre-oxygenation and induction. So two persons are needed, preferably an experienced person should be present. Optimal pre-oxygenation has to be done, NIV with 100% oxygen, a pressure support of 5 to 15 centimeters of water with a PEEP of 5 centimeters of water. Then if possible, HFNC can be given. So induction, since the patients may have a dicey hemodynamic situation or an impaired myocardial status, we use etomidate or depending on the other scenarios, ketamine can be used with succinylcholine anticipating the difficult airway, or rocuronium. We have to use cricoid pressure, then IPPV with a bag mask with a reservoir bag will be used. Say suppose this step is not possible, where face mask ventilation becomes unsuccessful, then a single attempt at tracheal intubation can be done only if the saturation is more than 95%. Say suppose we are able to manage the face mask, then we can try laryngoscopy and tracheal intubation, where we continue the nasal oxygen with 15 liters, then we try two attempts, maximum of two attempts, provided only if the SpO2 is more than 95%. Mask ventilation has to be done in between the attempts. We have to optimize the position, use external laryngeal manipulation, release cricoid pressure if needed, use a bougie or a stilet, consider changing the device or a technique or the operator in between the attempts. We have to maintain the depth of anesthesia in between. Say suppose this succeeds, then we can confirm the tracheal intubation using capnography. Say this fails, then we go on to the step of supraglottic airway device as explained by Soumya madam. If this is successful, then we can proceed with the technique of percutaneous or surgical tracheostomy, or you can intubate through a supraglottic airway device using a fiber optic bronchoscopy, provided expertise is available. Say suppose we are not able to intubate the patient with a supraglottic airway device, then what we are going to do? That would be rescue face mask ventilation, where we continue nasal oxygenation using 15 liters of oxygen or HFNC if available. We have to make sure that neuromuscular blockade is present, and a final attempt at face mask ventilation using optimal technique and adjuncts has to be done. If this is successful, then we can go for a surgical or a percutaneous tracheostomy. Say suppose this step is also not possible from us, then we call this step as complete ventilation failure. At this scenario, we have to call for additional help. We immediately have to perform emergency cricothyroidotomy. Again, we'll have to continue the nasal oxygen with 15 liters of oxygen or HFNC. Then we have to perform either a surgical cricothyroidotomy or a wide bore cannula cricothyroidotomy or a needle cricothyroidotomy. If this success, then we can convert the tracheostomy as early as possible. Now, what is the procedure plan? With each step, we can plan this way. Like, what is the further airway management plan that we can do? If in case airway edema has happened, how do we treat that? And how do we suspect it and how do we treat it? Then monitor for the complications. And we, of course, have to counsel and document. Now, what are the devices which are available for us to manage in case there is a difficulty with intubation or if there is a failure of intubation? First is, there's something called as a flexi-guide intubation guide to facilitate the airway management using a WHO scope. As you can see, this involves two parts where it looks like a Macintosh blade with a straight blade which has a lever at the proximal end. Near the bend of the device, we will place the tracheal tube along with the flexi-guide. Now, the flexible tip of this device can be maneuvered by manipulating the thumb ring at its proximal end. It's easier to introduce into the larynx than is a regular suction catheter. The technique involves the introduction of the WHO scope, which is loaded with the endotracheal tube and the flexi-guide into the oropharynx until the epiglottis and the vocal cords are brought into the clear view. It is similar to the regular laryngoscopy technique, except that we have a lever where we can maneuver the distal end and we can guide the flexi-guide into it so that we can insert the tracheal tube through the process. Now, next is the video laryngoscopy in ICU. As Dr. Sahajananda told, 80% of the intubations worldwide are being performed in this, especially in this COVID era, through video laryngoscopy. It's an indirect visualization technique for the larynx for the purpose of airway assessment or airway management in the ICU. The image from the video can be displayed, magnified, and recorded on a monitor. How do we describe an ideal video laryngoscope is? It should be intuitive, it should be lightweight, it should be low profile, it should be inexpensive, it should be easily maneuverable, easy to learn and master, remote view screen should be available with a memory storage capacity and long-lasting rechargeable batteries. With the COVID era, we also have this fogging concept where we need anti-fogging mechanisms to be present. Now, these are the brief description of the different types of video laryngoscopes that are available. We have three broad headings. One are the rigid blades, then we have the channel guided channels, then we have the video stilets. The standard blades, we have the CMAC and the VMAC. The angle blades commonly used are the McGrath, then we have the GlideScope, then we have the KingVision. The channeled blades we use are AirTrack and Pentax. Then we also use rigid stilettes like Bonfils retromolar stilet. Then we use Shikani's optical stilet. Now video stilettes, the stilettes are advocated when the mouth opening is limited. However, its applicability is just for oral intubation. The video stilettes are quite bulky, which requires space in the room with no anti-fogging mechanism. The Shikani optical stilet is a malleable stainless steel J-shaped endoscope with illumination fibers and a fiber optic bundle that can be used with a separate camera and monitor system or on its own with an optical eyepiece, as this has been described by Dr. Rashmi. Now, this is a picture depicting the Bonfils retromolar video laryngoscope. As you can see, it is a rigid video stilet with a camera attached to it with the display on the monitor. Next we have is the channeled video laryngoscope. We have two types of video laryngoscope, as we all know. We have the non-channeled and the channeled video laryngoscope. What is the advantage of having a channeled video laryngoscope is the placement of the tracheal tube through the channel that is being provided. So the representatives of this family are the Pentax and the AirTrack, as you can see in this picture. In the middle is the AirTrack, and on the left side of the picture is the Pentax, where we can attach a monitor so that we will be able to visualize. The AirTrack is a single-use optical device with optional video camera attachment. It is available in different sizes and can be used for nasal intubation, double lumen insertion. However, it is only of single use and requires 30 to 40 seconds for reduction of fogging. In case we have a difficult intubation, we can use this, but if we have a failed intubation, those amount of time we do not have. Pentax is similar to AirTrack with the advantage of only the plastic guide blades, which are disposable and it is quite less expensive. Then we have Rescue Scope, which is a similar device, but clinical studies are still limited. Then we have something called as the Glide Scope. The Glide Scope has an angulation of 60 degrees with anti-fogging camera with a plastic disposable blade and a separate view screen. Glide Scopes appear to be the most intuitive, easy to learn with the steepest learning curve, but it's a little bulky when we compare it with the rigid blades like a CMAC blade. That's why most of the clinicians prefer CMAC over Glide Scope. Then we have something called as a Sensascope. The Sensascope in appearance looks like the fiber optic bronchoscope, but this is used as hybrid intubation. Now, what is a hybrid intubation is, it has been designed and developed according to the clinical requirements for a safe, easy to handle and effective video assisted intubation. Why is it called hybrid? It's because the fact that the shaft of the instrument is combined with both rigid and flexible parts. Now, it is S-shaped, a rigid segment enables a very intuitive handling by one hand only, thus leaving the left hand free to operate a conventional laryngoscope. The tip of this device can be controlled via a steering handle in a similar fashion as that of a fiber optic endoscope. Now, next is the flexible fiber optic intubation. In this, the main indication of flexible scope intubation is, say, be it in the operation theater or in the ICU, is to secure the placement of the endotracheal tube when there is an anticipated airway difficulty and confirmation of tube position after intubation is necessary. One difference between a Sensascope for hybrid intubation and a flexible fiber optic bronchoscope is the flexible fiber optic bronchoscope cable, the entire length of it is flexible. So we need to stand at a higher position so that the entire length is straight and it does not bend. But in case of a Sensascope, we can insert the device even with uncomfortable position, and it is easier to maneuver. Now, it can be used in case of flexible scope intubation. It can be used in the management of abnormal airway anatomy, obstructive upper airway lesion, and unstable cervical spine to limit the cervical mobility. Now, coming to tracheostomy, which is the last resort in case of management of a failed intubation, we have percutaneous versus the operative technique. Percutaneous tracheostomy offers numerous advantages compared to the operative tracheostomy, wherein it requires less time to perform, it is less expensive, it is typically performed sooner because an operating room doesn't have to be scheduled. In addition, overall complications may be less frequent with percutaneous tracheostomy than surgical tracheostomy, even though percutaneous tracheostomy has an increased risk of anterior tracheal injury and posterior tracheal wall perforation. Now, coming to the other technique which we can use in order to secure a device before we go into a scenario of failed intubation and break our heads is ultrasound management of the airway. A very simple technique of analyzing the the airway is as shown in the device, where we can see the thyroid cartilage, where we can see the cricoid membrane, where we will be able to see the cricoid cartilage. If we have to measure the distance in each of this with the help of a caliper, with the measurement, we will be able to determine if there is a difficult airway or not, so that we can anticipate the problems. It's widely available, it is portable, it is repeatable, it's relatively cheap, it's pain-free, it is safe, and bedside machine in every operating theater and ICU suit. Then we have something called as a virtual endoscopy and a 3D reconstruction of the airway, probably in case of an ICU scenario with the limited scientific advances that we have currently, we may not be able to do. With the advancement of science, we will be able to manage as a portable device to develop a 3D environment where we determine the 3D picture of the airway. If there is a difficult airway, we will be able to determine that. Virtual endoscopy is a non-invasive technology by which two-dimensional or three-dimensional images are reconstructed with the help of a computer software from a high-resolution CT scan. The utilization of a 3D imaging package is now commercially available within the workstation delivered by different vendors worldwide. This, we can obtain the 3D models. So this is a picture of the 3D image of the airway, where we can see the nasopharynx, we can see the uvula, we will be able to see the oropharynx and the cricopharynx. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anaga. You have really risen to the occasion and been very brief. You managed to cover so many devices in a very short time without any repetition whatsoever. So considering that we have so many devices, we really need to, you know, see what our skill and use the device in which we are most skilled at or most sure of using. Moving on to the last talk of the day. Before that, I have one announcement to make. A, the certificates will be given. B, they will be a certificate of attendance will be given to the participants. At the end of the webinar, kindly feedback form will show. Kindly give your feedback and then the certificates will be sent to your mail IDs by the event managers. Our last talk today is an advanced airway. You know, we have all done routine airway, which we as anesthesiologists and intensivists are able to do. Now, our last talk, we are, however, faced with situations such as tracheomalacia, tracheal stenosis. It's quite common in most of the ICUs. I myself have seen several. And advanced airway management is required. Our pulmonologist, Dr. Vivek, who has done both his graduation and post-graduation from our college, RRMC, and he has done his interventional pulmonology fellowship from Italy. And he is going to talk, tell us some novel procedures which we can manage on central airway obstruction, a very frequent condition form. We always encounter all these foreign bodies and tumors, and also bronchoscopy in ICU. Over to you, Dr. Vivek. Thank you for attending our conference and our webinar.
Thank you so much. I would like to thank everyone for giving me this opportunity in this forum. Now, moving on to the topic, today's topic will be on bronchoscopy in ICU and management of central airway obstruction. Now, coming to today's discussion, we'll be discussing about bronchoscopy in ICU in intubated cases as well as non-intubated cases, and evaluation of central airway obstruction, classification of central airway obstruction, which will be useful in daily clinical practice, central airway disobstruction techniques. Now, coming to flexible bronchoscopy, it is essential a diagnostic as well as therapeutic tool in ICUs. It can be performed via endotracheal tube, tracheostomy tube, nasally, or through oral route. It's a bedside procedure, avoids transportation of patient to the operation room, and time-saving procedure. Now, coming to the spectrum of pulmonary diseases we come across in the ICU, it can be pneumonia, pulmonary edema, pulmonary hemorrhages, thromboembolic diseases, primary or metastatic carcinomas, interstitial lung diseases, obstructive airway diseases, or any of these diseases which will go for respiratory failure, and also complication of intubation and mechanical ventilation. Now coming to the common diagnostic ICU indication for fiber optic flexible bronchoscopy, it is usually done to inspect the airways for bronchoalveolar lavage and for intrabronchial transbronchial lung biopsies. Also evaluation of abnormal chest X-rays suspected also in suspected pulmonary infections in immunoptysis, lung carcinoma and obstructing neoplasm. Assessment of endotracheal tube, also in assistance during intubation, extubation, and to evaluate the position of the endotracheal tube, also in evaluation of the injury of the airway. Coming to common therapeutic ICU indications for fiber optic bronchoscopy, it is most commonly done in case of mucus plugs, retained secretion, hemoptysis, also done in drainage of lung abscess, debridement of necrotic and transbronchial mucosa, necrotic transbronchial mucosa, and dilatation of airway stenosis and in strictures. In case of pulmonary infiltrates, usually to evaluate the infection processes allows direct sampling of the secretions from the lung, which will help in identification of the pathogens, also help in de-escalation of antibiotics, potentially for indication of non-infectious process as well. So coming to the non-infectious process, I would like to discuss one case. This was the case presented to us 1 month back. The patient was a 15-year-old female child who was treated in a hospital in Tumkur. She was treated for viral pneumonia. As you can see, there is bilateral consolidation with atelectasis of bilateral lung. So as we evaluated further, patient was treated for 4 days with IV antibiotics and other supportive medications. Child was intubated. The case came to us. We got a CT thorax done. We suspected a foreign body. As you all can see in the left main bronchus, there is a radio-opaque foreign body. On further evaluation, we did a diagnostic bronchoscopy. We could see a tooth, loose tooth, which was dislodged in the left main bronchus. It was referred to a pediatric surgeon. The tooth removal was done, the foreign body removal was done, and the lung expanded quite beautifully. So now coming to the fiber optic bronchoscopy in retained secretion and atelectasis, versus physiotherapy, chest physiotherapy for retained secretion, it has no superior demonstration, but in case of lobar or greater atelectasis, which is not responding to aggressive chest physiotherapy, and also in life threatening whole lung atelectasis, fiber optic bronchoscopy will help a lot. It is not contraindicated in severe hypoxemia. It is expected to improve AA gradient, static compliance, radiography will improve in 4 to 8 hours post removal of the secretion or mucus plug. This was the case which was admitted in ICU with a picture of bilateral bronchopneumonia, more on the left side. The patient developed respiratory distress within 3 hours of admission. So we repeated X-ray, we could see a white-out lung on the left side. So a diagnostic bronchoscopy was done, which shows complete occlusion of the left main bronchus with a mucus plug. This was the X-ray. After extraction of the mucus plug, the lung has completely expanded. Now coming to the complication, pre-medication or local anesthesia complications such as respiratory depression, arrest, or methemoglobinemia can be seen. Procedure-related complications such as hypoxemia, cardiac complications, pneumonia can be seen. Ancillary procedures just like transbronchial biopsy, it can produce complications such as pneumothorax, barotrauma, pulmonary hemorrhage, and also very rarely because of these complications, death can occur. Coming to safety of bronchoalveolar lavage in ventilated patients with ARDS, this was the article published in Bronchol, volume 14 on July 12, 2007. This was a study conducted for 148 ventilated patients with ARDS in ICU, where fiber optic bronchoscopic BAL was done to investigate for VAP, ventilator associated pneumonia. No deaths or major complications were reported in this set of patients. Only two minor episodes of desaturation was seen. That was a fall of saturation of more than 6%, which occurred 2 hours after the BAL. With a complication rate of less than 1.5. So fiber optic bronchoscopy with BAL in ICU in ventilated ARDS patients is safe provided adequate precautions are taken. Now coming to the complications, cardiac complications, most commonly seen are arrhythmias and ischemic heart disease, which is which probably is exacerbated by hypoxemia and hypercapnia, which in turn increases the sympathetic tone, which leads to arrhythmias. Risk factors for developing these complications can be unstable angina, severe pre-existing hypoxemia. Now coming to fiber optic bronchoscopy in mechanically ventilated patients who are intubated and are on mechanical ventilation, the standard endoscope which we use is 5.7 mm scope, which occludes about 10% of the cross-sectional area of the trachea. If the patient is intubated, if it's a 9 mm ET tube, it covers almost 40% of the area. If it's a 8 mm ET tube, around 51%. And if it's a 7 mm ET tube, it covers about 66% of the internal diameter of the endotracheal tube. So most common complication that can occur with a bigger size endoscope is hypoventilation, hypoxemia, gas trapping, and high intrinsic PEEP. So standard, the 8 mm internal diameter ET tube is the standard endotracheal tube, which is preferred for endoscopy. Nowadays, we have ultra-thin bronchoscope, which can be used with even a 5 mm or 5.5 mm endotracheal tube. It reduces the potential for hypoxemia, hypercapnia, and dynamic hyperinflation. Now coming to fiber optic bronchoscopy and mechanical ventilation, the increased complication risk increases with in pulmonary conditions such as where the oxygen gradient in the arteries, if it is less than blood gas analysis, if it is less than 70 mmHg with a FiO2 of more than 70%, if the PEEP is more than 10 centimeter of HTO, 10 centimeters of water, and if the patient is in active bronchospasm. Cardiac conditions such as recent MI, unstable angina, mean arterial pressure of less than 65 mm of Hg, or if the patient is on vasopressors, CNS state like increased intracranial pressure, all these conditions can increase the complication risk in these patients. Complication rate of fiber optic bronchoscopy in ventilated patient is less than 10%. Minor complications segregate for about 6.5%. Major complication is less than 0.15%. Mortality is very rarely seen. Now coming to transbronchial biopsies, this was a study conducted by O'Brien et al. This study shows 14.3% of pneumothorax in 83 lung biopsies. Which was the most common complication which occurred during transbronchial lung biopsies, followed by hypoxemia, hypotension, hemorrhage, and tachycardia. So to conclude, fiber optic bronchoscopy is a very useful tool in ICU for diagnosis, therapeutic, as well as for palliative care, can be done in most of the indicated condition with minimal complications. Now coming to central airway obstruction, coming to the evaluation part, for the evaluation of central airway obstruction, medical history is very important. Pre-existing disease, if known, should be taken into consideration. For example, if it's a malignancy, you'll have to know the type of malignancy, stage of malignancy, if the patient is symptomatic or not. So physical examination is very important. See if the patient has tachypnea, fever, or Wernicke-Keppel syndrome. Tachypnea usually occurs in acute obstructions. Fever in case of infective obstructions like in mucus plug. Wernicke-Keppel syndromes will indicate malignant mass. CT thorax with contrast is very important. Pulmonary function test can be done in relatively stable cases, but not in ICU setup. Video bronchoscopy is essential to localize the lesion, to see the degree of extension of the lesion, to see the degree of stenosis, to assess the type of stenosis, and to see if the distal airways are patent. If at all, if there is any lesions, we can do a biopsy for diagnosis. If it is a malignant case, we'll have to plan for the treatment, and all the options should be considered depending on the life expectancy and the stage of the tumor. Now coming to types of central airway obstruction, as you can see, this is the intraluminal tumor or a granulation tissue, first type. Second type is distorted type or buckling type. third type is extrinsic compression, but probably by a mass or a lymph node encasing the bronchus. Fourth one is scar stricture. Fifth one is Cabot trachea, floppy membrane. Floppy membrane most commonly seen in tracheobronchomalacias. Abrupt transition or a web stenosis. The last one will be a tapered transition or a hourglass stenosis. Now coming to the assessment of the central airway obstruction, the intervention will be based on the severity of the disease, localization of the disease, and the degree of extension. To assess this, we'll do a bronchoscopy, bronchoscopy, CT, virtual bronchoscopy, probably MRI if it is required. Based on this, we'll segregate the type of structural stenosis. If it's an intraluminal obstruction or extraluminal obstruction, we'll have to identify this type of with the type of stenosis. Now, coming to the localization, usually trachea will divide into three parts: upper one third, middle one third, and lower one third, and each of the bronchi. The scoring, it will depend on the severity of obstruction. It goes from 0 to 5, 0 being the normal trachea, and 5 being the complete obstruction. So, based on this, we will decide on the next intervention. So, coming to the etiology of central airway obstruction. Malignant etiology, it can be a primary malignancy or a metastatic tumor. Benign etiology such as papilloma, lipoma, hematoma, and many other benign tumors. Structural will mainly divide central airway obstruction into structural abnormality and dynamic abnormality. Structural abnormality includes all these tumors. Dynamic abnormality will include the destabilized airway such as in tracheobronchomalacia or EDAC. Now, coming to disobstruction algorithm, before going into this, we'll have to assess the symptom of the patient, if the patient is symptomatic or not. If symptomatic, we'll have to assess the stage of the disease, if it's a malignant or a benign condition. Depending on that, we'll have to determine the treatment. Second will be identify the type of airway stenosis. Third will be treat the intraluminal component first. If there is an intraluminal or intrabronchial mass, we'll have to debulk it. We'll have to treat for that first and then stabilize the airway. Assess the residual degree of airway stenosis. If there is an intraluminal mass or a granulation tissue, once it is removed, we should assess the residual, if there is any residual stenosis, if it is less than 50% or more than 50%. More than 50% of stenosis will definitely require surgical correction or interventional correction, whereas less than 50% of stenosis doesn't require any surgical intervention. Treat the residual or mural component if the patient is still symptomatic even after doing the debulking or correction of the airway stenosis. Now, coming to benefits of treating a malignant CAO, central airway obstruction. Malignant central airway obstruction mainly done to improve the dyspnea, that is symptomatology, and to improve the quality of life. Malignant central airway obstruction, technically, it has a very good success rate. 93% success rate is seen, which ranges from 90 to 98%, depending on the case, where the airway lumen patency of more than 50% is obtained. Clinically, a significant improvement in symptoms, especially in dyspnea, and improvement in quality of life is seen. One of the studies conducted by Mohammed et al. Here we can see it was a study conducted in central airway obstruction, regardless of the cause. It can be a malignant etiology or a benign etiology. In all these conditions, as you can see, the spirometry, the dyspnea, the health-related quality of life, everything has improved compared to the status of the lung, status of the airway before intervention and after intervention. This is a study done by Chajed P. et al. Here, two groups of patients are taken. One group of patients with treated for all the patients are malignancy cases. In that, they are categorized into two groups: patients with central airway obstruction and patient without central airway obstruction. The first group is patient with treated central airway obstruction. Second is patients without central airway obstruction. Here we can see in both the cases, in both the groups there is almost equal survival equal life expectancy. So it indicates that if it reached the central airway obstruction, they have a good, better quality of life. Now coming to therapeutic bronchoscopy, it is usually done in symptomatic airway stenosis if it is more than 50%. Main goal is to improve the symptoms, survival, and quality of life. If the patient is symptomatic even after doing a therapeutic bronchoscopy in case of airway stenosis, if it is less than 50%, we can add a ancillary procedure like a stenting or a coiling. If it is not required, then we can do a balloon dilatation. Now coming to techniques of immediate disobstruction, there are two techniques mainly, hot techniques and cold techniques. Hot techniques will comprise of laser, electrocautery, APCs. Cold techniques will comprise of rigid mechanical debulking, cryotherapy, and airway stenting. One more technique I've missed in cold techniques is balloon dilatation. So which technique to use? It depends on the type and nature of the lesion, location of the lesion, availability of the equipment, training skills of the operator, specification of the technique. Now coming to hot technique, laser techniques, most commonly used is NDR laser or CO2 laser. It is a non-contact method. Precaution that has to be taken is FiO2 should be less than 40, eye protection should be there. You should protect the anatomy of the airways. Thermic effect, it depends on the distance, power, and duration of the laser. Coagulation is achieved between 10 to 20 watts, carbonization at 40 watts. Anything more than that will lead to vaporization. Usually it is used in intraluminal tumor to relieve the obstruction. Success rate is about 92% in malignancies. Now coming to APCs, it is the ionized argon gas carries a high frequency current. Flame goes to the nearest point. It is a non-contact mode. Precaution that has to be taken is a grounding pad and FiO2 of less than 40% should be maintained. There are two modes in APCs. One is pulse mode and is the second one is the forced mode. Pulse mode is usually used in hemostasis and coagulation to treat hemoptysis. Forced mode is usually used for recanalization and tumor debulking. One of the advantages of APC is it has a low risk of airway wall perforation. Now coming to electrocautery, there are different instruments which is available in electrocautery, that is probe, snare, knife, or forceps. It is a contact mode thermal ablation for conduction of electric current. Precaution that has to be taken is grounding pad FiO2 of less than 40% and should not be done in patients with pacemaker. Coagulation at very low temperature and vaporization at high temperature can be achieved. Effect depends on the power, duration, and area of contact to the tissues. This technique can be used in web-like stenosis, in resection of benign tumors, in granulation tissue, and also in palliation of malignant central airway obstruction. Now coming to cold techniques, airway stents are usually used as cold techniques, but I'd forgotten to mention one more thing, the balloon dilatation. Usually before leaving a stenosis, after electrocautery, we'll have to do a balloon dilatation and then place a stent. These are the different types of stent we'll come across, silicone stent. There are three main important types of stent. One is silicone, second is self-expanding metallic stent, third is biodegradable stents. Now coming to silicone straight stent, this is the gold standard stent used for 75% of the indication. There are few complications. One of the main complications of a stent is mucus plugging, second will be migration of the stent, third will be granulation tissue. The removal of this silicone stent is very feasible and it's safer. The technique of silicone stent placement will have a workshop in the hospital, which Ranglakshmi madam told, so we can teach you in that workshop. Now coming to this, this particular case, this patient was presented with a central mediastinal mass with a right upper lobe collapse. As you can see, there is a right upper lobe collapse. So this is the 3D reconstruction image. As you can see, there is a mass encasing the right main bronchus, which is occluding, which is compressing the right main bronchus. This is after the deployment of the stent. As you can see in the CT, there is a mass encasing the right main bronchus, where the stent has been placed, which maintained the patency of the right main bronchus. As you can see, a post-procedure X-ray, here the lung has been, upper lobe has been collapsed. Post-procedure X-ray shows complete expansion of the right upper lobe. Now coming to stent types, straight silicon stent are one of the type of silicon stent. We have around 2 to 3 types of silicon stent. One is straight silicon stent. Second would be Y-shaped silicon stent, that is bifurcated stents. Now coming to straight silicon stents, this type of straight silicon stent, one of the complications with this stent is migration of the stent. For example, if you deploy the stent in middle one third of the trachea, it might migrate to lower one thirds or migrate to upper one thirds. To mitigate this, they have come up with a new stent called hourglass silicon stent with migration of 0%. So this is the second type of silicon straight stent. This is a self-expanding metallic stent. Now use this silicon stent or any other metallic stents are used only after exploring all the treatment options. And complication rate in metallic stent is lesser in benign disorders and lower migration rate as compared to the silicon stent. But silicon, the self-expanding metallic stents has its own drawbacks. Excessive granulation tissue can grow, fractures of tortuous airways, colonization, and potentially it can cause respiratory infection. Now coming to differences between silicon stents and self-expanding metal stent. One of the main differences, self-expanding metal stent can be deployed through a flexible bronchoscopy, whereas silicon stent will require special apparatus and it should be deployed through a rigid bronchoscopy. It is little difficult to deploy it compared to metallic stents. It is easy to remove. The silicon stents are easy to remove and adjust, whereas metallic stents are permanent and it is very difficult to adjust. Silicon stents are prone for migration, whereas metallic stents remain more stable in the place. The on-site customization in size can be done for silicon stent using a scissor, whereas metallic stent customization cannot be done. It has lower inner-outer diameter ratio, whereas metallic stent has higher inner-outer diameter ratio. Metallic, one of the most common complication come across with metallic stent is it allows tumor ingrowth. So it should not be used in, most of the time it should not be used in malignant central airway obstruction. And also the silicon stent, it impairs the mucociliary clearance, whereas metallic stent maintains the mucociliary clearance. Now coming to bifurcated stents, this is a Montgomery T-tube stent. We use it for subglottic stenosis. This is a silicon Y stent and this is a silicon OK stent. Usually silicon Y stents are used in tracheobronchial compression of tracheobronchial corner and also in exophytic tumor growth in main carina. In this picture, you can see exophytic tumor growth. Both of the main bronchus are obliterated, almost obliterated. The tumor is excised using electrocautery and APC. After doing the excision, this is the stent placed inside the both the main bronchi. Y stent placed between in the both the main bronchi. And this CT images shows stenosis of the main bronchi as well as the stenosis of the trachea as well as the main bronchi. This is the airway patency maintained after placing the stent. This is the main bronchi. This is the trachea, which is patent after placement of the stent. These are the main bronchi, left and main bronchi, which is patent after placing the Y stent. Now to conclude, central airway obstruction, symptomatic patients, more often immediate effect is required. Bronchoscopic techniques are a part of multidisciplinary approach and adjunct to further treatment strategy. Aim is to reduce the symptoms, improve the quality of life and survival. There are two techniques, hot and cold techniques. Selection of intervention will be based on type of lesion, localization of lesion, characteristic of lesion, and depends on the short and long-term complications. Stents are good, but not yet good enough because of the biofilms, mucus stasis, and mucus plugging. It is a benign in benign tumors. It is a temporary condition. It is a temporary solution. It can be removed, and further surgical management can be planned. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vivek. The take-home message is that there is so much equipment available for us. While in case of a tracheal stenosis or a tracheomalacia or any collapsing trachea and central airway obstruction too, we have learned so much. So there are a few questions which some of them have been answered in the chat box and in the question answers. There are a few questions on HFNO. All the questions, I thank the attendees. I think they have been listening intently because every question is relevant. Dr. Soumya Joyce will answer. Dr. Soumya Sharma will answer. Is it the flow or the FiO2 which improves the SpO2 in HFNO?
Okay.
Soumya?
The most beneficial effects of HFNO is because of the flow. It is the flow which covers the inspiratory flow rate demand. And then it is because of the flow which offers the resistance to the expiratory flow and which causes PEEP. So flow is more important than the FiO2 in this case. So there is another question, how to set FiO2. Initially, we have to start with the flow. From 25, we can slowly increase up to 60 liter per minute. And FiO2 can be titrated according to the saturation of the patient to attain a saturation of 92%. So it is titrable independently along with the flow rate.
There is also a question on how reliable is ROCS index for HFNC, Soumya?
So ROCS index is a simple index which tells us about the success or failure of HFNC treatment, especially in patients with hypoxemic respiratory failure. It's a simple calculation. It is calculated by the formula saturation divided by FiO2 whole divided by respiratory rate. Now it is validated in hypoxemic respiratory failure patients. The calculation has to be done at 2nd hour, 6th hour, and 12th hour. But the reading which is done at the 12th hour has a positive predictable value of more than 80%. The value, if it is more than 4.8, suggests that the success is good. There is a low risk of intubation in HFNC patient, but with HFNC. But in COVID patients, it is yet to be validated.
Yes, so the take-home messages in COVID patients, many of these are yet to be validated. Dr. Sajananda has something to add on this. Sir? So please unmute yourself, sir. You are muted.
In one study, which is done by Solvi and al. In a critical care setup, shows that in COVID patients, they have validated and anywhere ROCS index between 3.8 to 4.5 is good. The patient may not go in for intubation. The ROCS index below 3.5 is supposed to say that, well, these patients might require intubation.
Yes, and so it is based.
Yeah, it's validated in a critical care setup also. There is an article accordingly.
Yeah.
And we should also not depend only on these numbers. Other things like work of breathing, accessory muscle usage, and patient discomfort, we should go ahead and escalate the treatment.
Totally correct and well said, Soumya. And there is a simple question. How do you place a mask on a patient with HFNO? You just place
HFNO, it. HFNO is provided through the nasal cannula, so we can place the surgical mask over the face. The thing here is the surgical mask captures the particles, bigger particles, and also it decreases the velocity of expired air, so there is less aerosol dispersion. Along with good ventilation, with good air exchanges and good quality PPE must really help the healthcare worker.
Yes, and Dr. Nikhil Pallath has complimented your presentation, Dr. Anaga. He has also asked how easier is it to perform a cricothyroidotomy in an emergent situation under ultrasound guidance.
Nikhil, can you hear me? Yeah, so actually doing a emergency cricothyroidotomy using ultrasound is much easier than the routine technique, where we have to determine the thyroid cartilage and then we have to go down the technique and then determine. So in case of ultrasonography, we use the linear probe, which is used for our blocks, right? So the same thing we're going to use, we're going to the frequency of which is around 7.5 to 11 megahertz. So we're going to place the probe linearly. Like, can you see this? This is going to be the probe placement. It's going to be placed like this. So this is going to be the placement. So now, what do we see in the images? Imagine this is the thyroid cartilage. Then this is the cricoid cartilage. Now, what happens is, if this is the thyroid cartilage, you'll see a shadow, a black shadow underneath it. Then you have a cricoid cartilage, which is down below the level of the thyroid cartilage. You'll see a black shadow underneath this as well. So you're going to see a structure like this. So in between these two is the cricothyroid membrane. So what you're going to do is, you're just going to place the probe linearly. You're going to determine the cricothyroid membrane and immediately you're going to poke it inside. So as soon as you poke it, you'll be able to see the air bubbles and insert. So it's much easier than the routine technique, where you are tensed, you are trembling. It's a difficult situation. Just have to place a probe, identify the thyroid cartilage, cricothyroid membrane, poke in. I hope I've answered the question. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Anaga. There is several questions, several requests. There are a couple of requests. One is for the certificate. You will all be given certificates after you give the feedback. At the end of this session, there is going to be a feedback which is going to appear. And kindly give a feedback on our presentations and then you will be given a certificate. Dr. Sajananda is going to answer another very important question. That is, how does to feed a patient while proning considering aspiration risks?
You have asked a pertinent question, all right. But then the answer is very difficult to answer you, because studies are still being done. But one particular study shows that the prone position or supine position, the residual volume in the gas stream is almost the same. So you can continue the prone position feeding using the Rankine tube. And there is an article in Critical Care my journal by Peter H.J. et al. They have also the same opinion. And I think that should be fine.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mangal Madhwal has asked, expressed his thanks and told when is the asked when is the workshop. Dr. Mangal, workshop will be announced on the GICS team. I am part of the Global Intensive Care Symposium team and our infrastructure, we are all ready. Whenever it is physically possible for everybody to come to our college, and when the conference takes place, it will be done. Tentatively, it is slated for after May next year. You have to get in touch with the organizers regarding the timing of the Global Intensive Care Symposium, Dr. Rangappa and Dr. Ajit Kumar. There is one question about gastric emptying before the intubation, semi-emergency intubation, which Dr. Soumya MJ has already answered. No, you are not supposed to do. I think she has answered why. Will you please tell them why, Soumya?
Sure, ma'am. One theory says if you go ahead and do a gastric draining, one theory says that it is useful. But the second theory says a lot about it. that the lower esophageal sphincter, which might be patent, when you put an NG tube pass the NG tube, it opens up and remains patent throughout later, thereby increasing the risk of regurgitation and later aspiration during your induction and intubation. The second one is, there is no guarantee even after putting an NG tube and draining, because the stomach, the food are present as pockets. So it's impossible to entirely drain it out. We have to place the patient on both the lateral sides and even sometimes prone to completely evacuate. So I don't think even if we drain it, it is still the stomach will not be emptied. And again, we have to take the aspiration risk prophylaxis and do a rapid sequence intubation. Since it's a semi-emergency, we can give a prokinetic, wait for some time, and then do a rapid sequence intubation anyway with cricoid pressure.
Thank you, Soumya. This new love, there is an anonymous attendee who has said that is the new love for HFNO and CRDS related to high infectivity and high mortality in both patients and the person who intubate. Partly right, whoever has asked this question, but you see, healthcare worker safety is also very important. So I would agree with you. And secondly, when we are getting an equal effect with the less exposure to yourself, definitely we need to follow it. So healthcare personnel are also important people. So that is the other thing. There are several requests for the PDF of the presentation. I am sorry, the whole presentation with the speakers is available on YouTube as a recording. Kindly go back and see the YouTube recording, those who have not been able to see the entire program. And the YouTube recording will be shared. So a PDF presentation normally is not given. They are the copyright of the speaker. However, the YouTube recording is there. There is another question. Is there a role to, the organizers have just put the YouTube recording link. Is there a role to intubate early in COVID patients when presenting with hypoxemia and metabolic acidosis over the use of HFNC? Yes, does anyone want to answer that? Does sir want to answer it? I would say there is a role of early intubation and tracheostomy because Dr. Soumya Sharma has already told, HFNC is not a blanket treatment for every patient of COVID presenting in ICU. We need to choose the patients. So probably I would say if their metabolic acidosis is already certain, I would say go ahead. But if there is, with all the precautions, if there are any differences, Sir Soumya, you can answer.
This particular question reflects on the clinical judgment. That is, there should be a conference between the intensivist, medical physician, and the anesthesiologist concerned. And you should, on a case-by-case basis, you have to decide whether you have to go ahead with intubation or tracheostomy. As per the patient is, earlier we used to say early intubation. There's a lot of debate as far as the early intubation is concerned, how early it should be. Now, all the patients should be immediately intubated. So then it has come to the a stage wherein you should judge the patient's condition, clinical features, then hypoxemic failure features, then the gas and other investigations, and then decide, and you can go ahead for the intubation. You can always, it's worth giving a trial of HFNO or HFNC in those patients. Again, various indices you have to look for, ROCS index or the gas investigations, FiO2 to FiO2 ratio, etc. And then decide whether to go for intubation or wait for nasal cannula.
So can you hear me or have I exited? No. I'm not too sure.
I can hear you, ma'am.
Yeah, so thank you very much. I thank the organizers, Dr. Rangappa, Dr. Rajit Kumar. I wish to share with our team that I have personally received a lot of appreciative messages on my WhatsApp. Please give us a feedback. And Vinay, can we exit? Thank you very much. I'm sorry we extended the time a bit. There were a few questions also. Vinay?
Yes, ma'am.
Sure.
Yeah. Thank you. I thank all the panelists for taking out their time. Thank Dr. Vivek, despite his heavy schedule, to talk to our team. And all the speakers, Dr. Sajananda, Dr. Soumya, Dr. Anaga, Dr. Soumya Sharma, Dr. Jyoti, and Dr. Rashmi. And thank you all. And we will end this meeting today. Thank you again, Dr. Rangappa and Dr. Ajit Kumar and the entire team of intensivists who place their confidence in us in order to conduct this BICEP program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rangappa.